ideastream.org and the IdeaStream public media app. This annual event's mission is to acknowledge and reflect on the extraordinary work of Dr. King and pay tribute to those who continue his legacy of service. This uplifting concert will showcase prominent Black composers, music in the African American spiritual tradition, and celebrate the 2022 recipients of the orchestra's Dr. Thank you.
Good morning. Today is Monday, June the 6th. This Committee of Finance, Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion and Committee of the Whole is called to order. This is Committee of the Whole. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Griffin.
Here.
Bishop.
Here.
Conwell. Gray.
Here.
Harrison. Marsh.
Here.
House.
Here.
Jones. Hayden.
Present.
Moore. McCormick. Mooney.
Here.
Valencic. Santana.
Present.
Slide.
Present.
Spencer.
Present.
Starr. Mr. Chairman, here with Warren.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. We're going to start out, and if we could we have the presenters for the Commission on Black Women and Girls join us at the table. I believe Director Shute Woodson is going to take the lead on this, and she can introduce our guests. This is Ordinance Number 373-2022, as amended by Mayor Bibb and Council Members Gray and House, an emergency ordinance to supplement the codified ordinances of Cleveland, Ohio, 1976 by enacting new sections 162-01, 162-02, and 162-03 relating to the creation of the Commission on Black Women and Girls. And I am going to defer to my colleagues House and Gray. However, Ms. Shute Woodson, please introduce your guests and please proceed with your presentation.
Sure. Good morning. Thank you, Chair. Thank you to this council body. The Bibb administration would like to specially thank, before getting started, Councilwoman House and Councilwoman Gray. As co-sponsor to this legislation, they have weighed in tremendously and have we deeply appreciate their input and guidance for today. So why the Cleveland Black Women Commission on Women and Girls? If you would go to the first slide, and I hope you all have a packet from us. This is all driven by data that was focused on Cleveland. And in the first slide, we talked about how Cleveland is one of the most segregated metropolitan areas in the nation, and that was due to the Brookings Institute from 2018. We talk about our population as far as how it relates to the city overall, the African-American percentages in our city, as well as the Black women percentages in the city. But most of all, why the commission? So the City of Cleveland Commission on Black Women and Girls serves to improve the quality of life for women and girls by advocating, initiating, and championing programs, as well as legislation to strengthen families and communities. Our vision is real simple. Every woman and girl in the City of Cleveland has access to unlimited opportunities to achieve social, health, and economic equality. The purpose of the commission is basically to advise the mayor, this body here, City Council, city directors, and citizens of Cleveland on matters that influence the well-being of Black women and girls in our city. It will explore and research, issue reports, the status of Black women and girls in our city. It develops and maintains an information and referral service to respond to Black women and girls' needs. It will hold public meetings and hearings pertaining to Black women and girls. It proposes initiatives to remove inequality and biases of sex, recommending programs and legislation to ensure equal rights and opportunities for all women, and to address the inequalities and disparities in regards to economics, health disparities, and social conditions. I now really want to turn it over to Enlightened Solutions, because I know we don't have a whole bunch of time, and I want them to introduce themselves, who are here at the table, who are part of the City Lab study in addition to Project Noir. So I'm going to let them introduce themselves and go over the data portion to help us arrive at this piece of legislation in front of you today.
Chairman Griffin, esteemed council members, my name is Chinenye Nkemra of Enlightened Solutions. Thank you so much for your time today. First, we humbly acknowledge and thank the over 450 Black women from Cleveland who trusted us with their lived experiences, which led to this transformational opportunity here today. In 2020, Cleveland was ranked the worst city in America for black women underneath healthcare, workplaces, and education. This is a comprehensive study from the University of Pittsburgh and published by CityLab Bloomberg. This research helped us understand where we rank, but it did not help us understand why we rank so low. The most jarring piece that I learned from this research was that no statistician interviewed any black women in any of the major metropolitan areas, the best places or the worst places at all. We, Enlightened Solutions, wanted to understand the tactics, barriers, and strategies that contribute to failing black women specifically and profoundly.
Hi, I'm Bethany Studenick. I'm the co-founder and managing director of Enlightened Solutions. Because of Chi-Chi's hard work, and community outreach, we received over 100 responses in 24 hours. By the time we closed our survey, we had received over 450 responses from black women in our community and over 470 responses nationally. We actually had to shut down the survey because we received so many responses. Community members shared almost 1,000 stories of harassment, discrimination, and abuse across systems in Cleveland. We hand-coded this data utilizing qualitative data analysis and artificial intelligence tools in order to enhance our accuracy. We also sat down and engaged in 1 to 2 hour individual conversations with black women from across our region who volunteered to deep dive into their experiences. Their thoughts and perspectives guide our work every single day.
Black women from Camp's Corner to Union Miles trusted us, and their stories reinforced each other. In a city with groundbreaking healthcare institutions, black women are disbelieved about their pain and symptoms, sent home with injurious to fatal consequences. At work, qualified black women are exited from entire industries in this city due to daily race-based and gender-based microaggressions. In classrooms, educators are steering inquisitive black young women into lower-paying professions due to their own conscious and unconscious bias. Systemic racism and sexism is a result of thousands of choices made by professionals across our day or across our city each and every day. It is a network of behaviors that are predictable, measurable, and correctable.
Cleveland should be a major economic attractor. We offer affordable housing during the rise of remote work and an active housing crisis. We are situated on one of the largest bodies of fresh water in the world during a looming climate crisis. We are also a city with a civil rights history during a nationwide reckoning with rights and ethics. Cleveland may be at the bottom today, but we believe this makes Cleveland the best place to solve some of the most challenging problems facing our world today. We believe in solving for the hardest problems first. By investing in black women, we confront both racism and sexism simultaneously. The reality is that when black women thrive, everyone thrives. We believe that if we can solve this in Cleveland, we can solve it anywhere. Thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you so much, Director, and thank you so much to both of our guests. Appreciate this. We know this is a very important topic. I know that you have a lot of statistics in here and a lot of data that has driven this, so I'm going to defer mainly to the two drivers of this process. So I'm going to defer to Councilwoman Gray first, and then Councilwoman House, if I could. Would you like to add anything to this effort or any comments?
I would like Councilwoman House to go first. Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Councilwoman House.
Thank you. Through the chair, to our guests, thank you so much for your presentation. In looking at the variety of statistics, what do you think, or where do you think potentially a commission on black women and girls, what can it, or how can it help to change the trajectory?
Through the chair to Councilwoman House. We believe that there are hundreds, if not thousands, of different solutions that we could surface. What Project Noir found was that there is a systemic network of behaviors across the city that are causing problems. They are predictable behaviors. We need to design and we need to understand those behaviors, and then we need to design counterpoints and counterweights to combat these issues across the city. So we may not know exactly what all the solutions are going to be right now, because the whole point of this is allowing black women to have a platform to look at the descriptive statistics and then put together what they think is the best interventions for them as a community, targeting these systemic issues. So it's about centering that expertise and lived experience.
Right, and just a follow up through the chair to our guests, I think guests highlighting, and that's one of the things that I'm glad that you brought it up, is this is creating an opportunity for Black women and girls to actually begin to focus on the agenda that they believe is best in working in partnership with the City of Cleveland. Is that correct?
Absolutely. We want solutions that are generated from Black women. No more solutions top-down designed by people who don't share those intersections. It's time for Black women to be able to identify the problems, design the solutions, and hold systems accountable from their own perspective.
Okay.
And more than that, the data is evenly dispersed throughout every single one of the neighborhoods represented here, all 17 wards. It's evenly distributed east and west. I know that there are a lot of concerns about it may just be more heavily weighted, but if you look inside our packet, and we will provide addendums as well, it is completely evenly distributed between east and west. So when we say Black women in Edgewater and Black women in Buckeye Shaker, we truly do mean that it is completely and totally distributed that way.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Councilwoman Gray, did you have any comments you'd like to add?
Well, thank you, Chair. The question is for me is, even though that the data has shown that has been equally distributed throughout the whole 17 wards, how the benefit and the impact of the urban areas of the, all the 17 wards would impact the young girls who are not aware of this commission that's being brought to, and how effective that it can help them mentally and emotionally, since they haven't had any awareness of what and who can help them.
I guess I'll add through the chair. You're completely and totally correct. When we dispersed Project Noir, this was August 2020. This was during the height of COVID. We had over 100 responses in the first day. Imagine what we can do now, 2 years later, as our society has opened up a lot more. There are more opportunities to be able to market this. There are more opportunities for more younger Black women to be able to participate in this process. This is the best way that we would be able to invest young people who are the lifeblood of this city. So we are determined. We are very determined to be able to push this through and to be able to invest the younger members of our city in a way that will keep them here in our glorious and beautiful city.
Well, that's beautiful. And also, Chair, to the committee, anyone can answer this. That was beautiful.
I was a teacher. Well, I love children. Yeah.
Yes, that was beautiful. Second and final question is to the fact of other women who have the expertise and the education and the experience to come in to embrace these young girls, to bring them up and raise their mind up to the level that they are dreaming to have. Have you reached out to those women to also help the young girls to understand, you know, where they need to go?
Through the chair to Councilwoman Gray, there's a lot of work that needs to be done there. What you're talking about is a need for education, a need for a place where young Black women can have mentorship, that where they can come and have conversations, where they can have safe space. That's what we're looking to create here. What we often don't recognize is that systemic racism, systemic misogyny, it causes trauma. We call it systemic trauma. And so many folks across Cleveland are struggling with systemic trauma, being betrayed by systems, not being able to trust systems, going to the doctor's office and having them mess up so badly that you lose your life or someone that you love, right? So what we understand here is that we need to create a platform where Black women can discuss these issues, create solutions, and come together to channel their shared pain into actual change. That is one of the things that we've seen be the most healing for individuals who have experienced systemic trauma and who continue to be pushed out of systems, is how can we channel that pain into substantive change?
Yes. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Chair.
And I just wanted to piggyback through the chair to Councilwoman Gray, also with the commission in us all meeting together establishing this. We recognize that even though the commission will be of different various age groups, mm-hmm. it will specifically have a subcommittee focusing just on younger girls to let these girls really have a voice and input mm-hmm. To help build what their needs are mm-hmm. and help identify maybe the mentorship and so forth and encouragement as we further this.
Thank you, beautiful answers. Thank you, guys. Appreciate you.
All right, thank you. Councilwoman House has graciously asked for a few subject matter experts, so I'm going to ask for Alasia and a couple of her guests that she wanted to speak on this topic, if they could come forward. Once they make their comments, then we're going to open it up for a couple of questions from our council, okay? Please join us. I know that we have a few seats. We may have to rotate a couple out.
Their mics. I don't know you guys can stay.
And please tell us who you are, and as protocol, please always direct all of your comments through the chair, and then I will redirect the conversation to the appropriate council member. Thank you.
Okay.
Please proceed.
Good morning. I would like to thank Council President Griffin and members of Cleveland City Council for giving me an opportunity to speak on Ordinance 373-2022, establishing the Cleveland Commission on Black Women and Girls. My name is Alasia King, and I am currently a junior at Cleveland School of Science and Medicine. I also take classes at Tri-C Community College. I am a youth development worker at Sterling Recreation Center, and I am also the MIAC, standing for Mayor's Youth Advisory Council person chosen to represent our center. As Black women and girls, we are fighting for equality in areas such as corporate America, education, and social network. Not only am I here to speak on behalf of myself, but my peers as well, along with my Black mentors, teachers, and coworkers. In this day and age, our communities are struggling to stay afloat, barely surviving from day to day. Can anyone tell me how many young women or young Black girls suffer from poor mental health issues? Can anyone tell me how many Black women or girls suffer from self-harm or commit suicide? No, me either. And why is that? Studies have shown that Black women and girls are less likely to seek and or accept care, that we do not have enough resources presented to us, not being able to take care of yourself or your family if you have one, being physically unhealthy but not having the funds to see a doctor, being targeted simply because the color of your skin. If this legislation is passed, we are potentially saving thousands of lives. With this legislation, we are showing Black women and girls that we are fighting for them, and they should continue to fight for themselves. We are offering resources, we are offering safe spaces and welcoming or engaging in tough conversations with one another. We are trusting each other, being confident that when one of us is struggling, we will have a village to reach out to. If this legislation is passed and we successfully get the word out, because what's the most infamous saying? Words mean nothing unless we have the actions to back it up. So really, if we could put the action behind this legislation, I see great things in the future for our Black women and girls. As someone once told me, if you don't stand for something, you will fall for anything. I would like to thank Councilwoman Gray, Councilwoman House, and Mayor Bibb for introducing the ordinance to create the Cleveland Commission on Black Women and Girls. Thank you to the council members for listening to me, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
First of all, outstanding. Can we give her
thank you.
I mean, I tell you, we hear all about what's wrong and what's bad happening in Cleveland. This should just make your day just to see how you just sat there and just eloquently stated that. We could just vote and go home. That's just vote for this and go home. But thank you so much. I do want to make sure that we hear from our other guests. We have a couple of other guests. I think I want to make sure I hear from them. And then I believe we have Margie from the UAW that's here as well as a subject matter expert. and then I'll go into questions from my council colleagues.
I have a guest too.
Oh, you have a guest?
Yes, I do.
Where's your guest?
Joy Johnson.
Could you bring up Joy?
Yeah.
Is that our Burtonville car?
Yes.
Joy Johnson? Okay.
She's in the community.
Awesome. Oh, absolutely. Okay, so we're going to hear from Marjorie, and then we'll hear from Joy, okay? Marjorie.
Good morning. Thank you, Council President Griffin and council members. I didn't prepare anything for this, but I appreciate the opportunity to be allowed to speak. As you know, I'm not just a UAW member, but I'm a General Motors tool and die maker for over 25 years. And I know and I have witnessed the possibilities and the extent that women can come out of poverty through the trades. Years ago, the trades was in all the high schools. Now you have, right. What, a couple?
Yeah.
If it was back in all the high schools, we probably wouldn't be discussing this today, but we are. But it's so important that you bring this out of committee, because the only way you can, because when you bring women out of poverty, you bring families out of poverty. So this is something that needs to be done now. I witnessed, even in the trades, the discrimination against women and the holding back information from us so that we can move forward. But, and I've watched women bail out because of this discrimination. So, you know, we always worked hard to keep them in it and try to get them to not bail out. I've been a member of Hard-Headed Women on the board for many years until it broke apart, but now I'm with the Lorain County Hard-Headed Women of Ohio, and this is so very important. I'm hearing about the 1-2 project, so I hope that you can all come together and know and believe by supporting this, you're supporting women and girls. So thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you so much. Appreciate all you do for UAW and also for women. Thank you. Joy Johnson.
Good morning to the chairman, to the council members here. I'm happy to be here this morning. My name is Joy Johnson, and I am the executive director of Burtonville Car Development. We're a nonprofit community development corporation that works in Cleveland Central, Kinsman, and Buckeye neighborhoods. In early 2021, Literary Cleveland asked Black women to respond to the City Lab report on our poor outcomes in this city. The day that I saw the call for poems on Facebook had been a particularly rough one for me. The question posed by Literary Cleveland to Black women was, "How are you coping?" In response, I submitted a poem called "I Am Not." One line from the poem continues to ring true for me today. The city I love doesn't love me back. As a community development professional, our organization was asked to work with a team completing the memorial garden for 11 women who lost their lives on Imperial Avenue. Burtonville Car was asked to join the project team in April 2020, the same year that the City Lab report was released, and 11 years after these fellow Black women lost their lives. A part of our appeal in our fundraising was one of shame. Why did it take our community so long to honor these women, after it took us so long to even find these women years earlier? As the mother of a Black girl and the daughter of a Black woman, all born and raised in Cleveland, I commend Council Members Gray and House for acting quickly and proposing this legislation. They saw the data from City Lab and immediately took action upon starting their term in City Council. I urge their colleagues in council to pass this legislation so that every Black woman in Cleveland can love this city and know that it loves them back.
Amen.
Thank you. All right, I'm going to hear any questions from my colleagues. The first up, I have Mr. Fatherhood himself, Kevin Conwell. He can start us off, and do any other council members? Oh, Councilwoman Santana, and then Councilman Mike Palencic. Councilman Conwell.
Thank you very, very much. You know, when way back, which you guys might not know, but you know, Angie, you know, I pioneered the fatherhood movement, and we created a fatherhood commission downstate, and the governor, Bob Taft, I said, you weren't born, he was the governor, but Bob Taft gave us $620,000 to push the fatherhood commission. It was $310,000 one year, and $310,000. It was 2 years biennium out of his budget. And we opened up, it was fathers and families together, and we opened up shops at Corey United Methodist Church, 11111 St. Clair Avenue. I'm just giving you some background history because this reminded me of it. Then we did the Maydugan Center also. And we had a Spanish fatherhood group, Santana, at the Maydugan Center. And then we did one on the southeast side with Reverend Stewart, who just passed away, and God bless his soul. And we would go out and recruit dads. And we recruited the fathers, and we promoted father-child bonding, fatherhood engagement. And we taught the fathers that the best thing a father can do for his children is to respect his children's mother. It was programs, and we did evaluations with it, and it ended up going national. And then I am getting on city council, so this reminds me of that. But what we did, looking at the background history, I know this through Kimberly Dent. She's over the Fatherhood Commission. It's a female named Kimberly Dent. This over, she's been over the Fatherhood Commission, really, for how long Kimberly been there? For probably 15 years, and went through Jobs and Family Services. And so we took TANF dollars, the Town of Temporary Assistance for Needy Families, and we funded, and we are funding the fatherhood group. We put at least $10 million aside for to fund the fatherhood group. And now I think it's down to about $1 million or $2 million. But we use TANF dollars, and what you guys, I see in your commission, I read your stuff, that's the way to go. I'll give you Kimberly Dent's phone number. I'll meet with you, we'll do the TANF money. And you have a certain person there that's sitting at the table named Angela. She even called me to be on the, you know, to keep pushing the commission downstate because it was dying. I think that for funding, even statewide, when you look at this and you evaluate it from the evaluation process, you could start a commission on black women and girls even downstate. We'll take the model and use it downstate. You know, you would have to get a state rep or a state senator to push the legislation downstate. The woman, you got an expert on here. She know how to do it anyway. House, no. Yeah, she from there because she could talk. She got her friends. They could. I'm not telling you what to do, but I'm just giving her the background history, how we did it in the 90s, House. And you know how to do it. She know how to do it. She know all the key players. I'm putting you on the spot. I thought about it, because any time I would go downstate, I always saw Councilwoman House down there. She still looks, she got a state rep look on right now, you know. She is valuable, you can use her. She knows how to navigate through that, how to get this started downstate, and the Jobs and Family Service, all the key people, and how we can get the funding, because you're gonna need funding. This gotta be everlasting. It can't be, Mayor Bibbs project. It got to be for the Council of Women and Commission on Women and Black Girls. It can't be a politician. What we did with the Fatherhood Group, looking at the history, we kept the politics out of it. You got to keep that out of it. And then when you do that, even when the key pioneers and the players leave, it will be everlasting. It will be everlasting. You see, I'm talking about from the 90s on to now. It's everlasting. State reps, state senators leave and go. They sit on the commission just to champion the cause. But it's not ours. It's not Mayor Bibbs. It's everlasting for you so you can continue with this to move this forward. You're going to need also probably a retreat to get away so you can put all the key players, so you can put systems and structures and bring in expert opinions to put it into work. We have, matter of fact, I think I still have some of the Fatherhood Commission. I was gonna bring it today. It's in my cabinet. It's in my cabinet at home. But it's for dads, but it's how to create
for right
a commission. Mm-hmm. It's there. You know, Angie, you called me in to get it done. I think I still have some of the workings there. And you can take a look at it to look for lessons learned. Now what we did, this is interesting, I'm not gonna give you the whole story, that at the table. We had a council of, what was that? It was called a Council of Women. Also, that was in the fatherhood piece. But then we had to drill down on the father's side of it. But it was the Council of Women, that was a good piece. That was fun. That was really, really fun. And they were teaching the dads a lot in how to be nurturers, the whole nine yards. You know, so it's this is good. This is great. You even have, the reason I'm talking for long, because my expertise with it. You even have women that's in prison. You could do an inside-outside mom's program and have a child connected, because it's really about the children, and have a child connected with their mother. So when moms stay connected with their children, even when they get out of prison, inside mom's program, girls there, but when you have engaged mothers and you knock down barriers to employment, you knock down barriers to for them to move ahead, that's a beautiful thing. And in my neighborhood, 3/4 of the head of the household is headed by females. Mm. And you have mothers that's working from can't see in the morning to can't see at night. Mm. So their children are out there being latchkey kids running the streets. And even when you see council members, basketball courts in front of a house, it's because the mother told the child and the oldest one to stay and watch the children. And that's why they're playing basketball in front of the house. And that's why you see that, because the mother is trying to do whatever she can do to keep that family together. Mothers and families together. Mothers and families together. So in your stuff, the evaluation will be good. The evaluation process, I would talk with the state about setting one up, a mother commission. I will work with you. I tell you what else I would put in this, looking over it, because I'm really happy, a workshop. You got to do, when you do your evaluation process, you have to do a workshop, and you'll have women coming from all over to learn from you, so whatever you got can benefit other mothers and families together and things like that. But that workshop in here, the City of Cleveland will sponsor a workshop every other year. You put that together to talk about issues and concerns, because what you don't want to do is put this as a back burner. You got to evaluate it, you bring in experts, you do the women workshop, you bring in from all over. And then that will grow from what you're doing, from just local, then it could grow into a national movement to help everybody. Because what you want to do, you want it for the outcome measures, you want to cultivate other communities so we can have a better understanding. So that we can have a better understanding, and that's very, very important. So I'm there.
Yeah. Right, Council.
Yeah, and one more thing. I tell you what I would do on my commission. Their mission is kind of similar, correlated with yours, the YWCA. The YWCA. Young, I think it's Young Women Christian Association. Mm-hmm. When you have that, it's easier to be able to pull some dollars. And I'm going to say another conclusion. Looking at funding, you with the Congresswoman down there. When the fatherhood movement first got funded, it was funded by Lou Stokes. And it was a guy named Charles Ballard from out of Huff told Lou Stokes, and they started the teen fatherhood movement. So Congressman Lou Stokes had them to testify in Congress. And it's your evaluation process that she could bring you down there to Congress to testify in front of them, and then Charles Ballard was able to receive from the Appropriation Committee more dollars to push the fatherhood movement. So it's a good thing to have this, to put systems in place. Pre-testing, post-testing is a good outcome measure. And then you have me also that you can ask questions to, and I'll help. Thank you and God bless.
Thank you so much, Councilman. I want all council members to make sure we keep in mind that we are gonna stick within our time limit because we got a lot of pieces of legislation to get through. So I wanna make sure we do that. And Carrie McCormick is gonna be my timekeeper, and Jasmine Santana is going to be my sergeant at arms. So I got my two right hands are going to help us out. All right. Councilwoman Santana, then Councilman Polensic, Star McCormick.
Thank you, President. Good morning, all. This is a huge deal. I mean, I hope you guys get a chance to celebrate after this vote. I'm a strong believer. Healthy women changes the landscape of a community, of neighborhood, of our city. I've done my share of programs, 20 years out working with Women Health. And one of the questions that I have for you, I don't have experience with the commission through the chair, and anyone could answer over there, is the sustainability of it. And one of the things that we struggled in creating women's health programs is that investors normally don't see the impact and how it transforms down the line, right? Because it's a long-term transformation, and I'm just curious to know, what's your plan for sustainability for this program?
Through the chair to Councilwoman Santana. Sustainability.
Please speak into the microphone.
Oh, sure.
Thank you.
Sustainability is a really important piece of this, right? It's without any backing, we're not going to be able to do a whole lot, to the point over here that we need to be out in the communities having conversations. So sustainability-wise, we do have a couple of models that we're looking at. So Enlightened Solutions is a 501c3 nonprofit organization, and we are a social enterprise. So we generate revenue by generating solutions. Mm-hmm. So we work with corporations, we work with other nonprofits, we work with government entities to implement what we're doing. For this particular initiative, we have a couple of ideas. I'm going to be relatively general because they're still in the back burner. But one potential way is thinking about making referrals to attorneys, so building a referral network. That's a way of earning income. We can actually work with attorneys to get fees back from the litigation if we are helping people move their cases forward or we're making referrals. There's grants, obviously. There's earned income. There's government backing. There's state backing, as we've talked about, TANF dollars. There's a lot of different ways to go about this. It depends on what direction the committee members want to take. Sustainability is an important piece because money guides the choices you make. So we want to be very intentional with who we partner with on this and how we fundamentally think about the way that it upholds itself long term. So that's why we're a little, there's no hard and fast rule. We don't want to set any rules until committee members are sat and have a say in how this is supposed to be structured. Because we need to be very careful and intentional about how we ensure this happens long term.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Just to add through the chair, this is an economic issue as much as it is a racial and gendered issue. Anytime individuals are Googling Cleveland, they are seeing that this is a worst city in America for black women. That is an economic problem for this region, not just for individual wards. This means individuals, millennials like myself, that are interested in moving to places, this is the rise of remote work, are Googling this place and they are not interested in moving here. If we're able to move the needle, even slightly, we are able to be able to recruit individuals that would like to work here. We have tons of corporations here that are willing and ready to work with young individuals that want to start families and want to invest in this region. So we need to start flipping the idea of, is this going to be sustainable? And more about, is this going to lead us to be a 21st century city and a city that is stable economically?
And then just my last question through the chair. Thank you, Chichi, for that. Is the city funding this? Is the mayor's office funding this commission? Or where does the funding come from?
Director.
Can I chime in, Councilwoman?
Councilwoman House.
Thank you.
Councilwoman Santana, will you allow Councilwoman
yes.
House?
Thank Councilwoman you. Just House, to, so that has been a point we've been going back and forth on that. So as it stands right now in the legislation, there is no compensation similarly to many of the advisory commissions. Within that, I know there'll be conversations, prayerfully it'll get passed, and when the commission members come together to think about what would that look like as far as any compensation and as was laid out, the plan of sustainability economically. But as of right now, the short answer, no.
Thank you, Councilman, to the chair.
Yeah, thank you, everyone. And so just once again, congratulations to my colleagues. I think this is a huge deal, and all council members really need to support this. And if that's finance, you know, that's expertise, if that's finances, but this needs to be, you have to have the funding for it to be sustainable, because I don't think you'll see the impact 5 years, 10 years down the line in the city of Cleveland. But thank you and congratulations.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Thank you so much. Councilman Mike Polensic.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, my honorable colleagues, and to everyone who's at the table today. I want to commend my two colleagues for sponsoring this legislation. I have some observations and then some questions as well. I've lived in Cleveland all my life, was born in the Glenville neighborhood, raised in Collinwood by a single mom who raised four of us. So I know how she struggled, and I know the challenges that she had, and I heard repeatedly over the years how she felt it was very unfair that women were not paid the same amount as her male counterparts. I heard that repeatedly. And toward the end of her life, when we would talk, I heard many of the challenges that she had. My question is to the panelists that are here today. We've had a lot of representation in council over the years. We've had numerous mayors over the years. Tell me vividly and to the point, what do you think, or what do you believe has been the problem in this city? Why, and step back a moment. When I saw the statistics that Cleveland is the worst city in the country for black women, I was outraged, embarrassed. I don't know how else to describe it. I think we see Cleveland at the top of most negative lists and at the bottom of most positive lists. Tell us, where do you think the city has failed? Where is leadership? We've had black mayors. We've had black council presidents. And black business leaders. Where do you think the city has failed collectively? Where have we not addressed our attention? And I want to say to Ms. Chambers as well, I really appreciate you being here at the table, because I'm a former United Auto Worker. That's how I got my start in politics. And when you mentioned about the schools, at where I was a United Auto Worker at White Motors, there were women all over the plant working in all sections of the plant who went to the Cleveland public school system. And as you indicated so articulately, that's been taken away from our kids. Our kids have been written off in this city. So I think this is a big, in my opinion, a big reason, a big part of why we're in this situation today. Because when I talk to young ladies at Collinwood and at Glenville High School, they've asked me repeatedly, why can't we have a cosmetology program in our schools? Why do we have to go to Shaw High School for a cosmetology program? And I hear all these other requests and concerns that have been ignored. So I'm hoping that the commission and my colleagues, I hope one of the big drill downs on the commission is going to be about curriculum within a Cleveland public school system and the failures within our school system, fail to address the basic needs of our residents and their children. But I'd like to hear, where do you think the city has failed or has not addressed the issue properly or adequately?
Through the chair to Councilman Polensic. First, I'd like to say, it's not just our city,
okay,
right? The problems that we're facing here are a microcosm. They're exceptionally pronounced here in Cleveland. But the problem is facing our entire nation, our entire world. Equality, what does that mean in the 21st century? What we've seen is that in many conversations, we're not really getting to the heart of the issues. The heart of the issues is behaviors. When we talk about systemic trauma, we think about systemic racism. It is because humans make active choices every single day based on these feelings that they have, these biases that they hold. Behavioral change is exceptionally difficult. If you've ever tried to start a new habit or lose weight or eat healthier, it's hard. So doing that on a systemic level is an insane challenge. But we really think, being here in Cleveland where the issues are pronounced, this is the perfect place to start. It's the perfect place to understand it because these issues are pronounced. Chi-Chi and I are really looking at applying big data in service of individuals that we are trying to serve. That's how Project Noir was transformative. It wasn't fancy, really. It's descriptive data. It was a bunch of fractions, right? At the end of the day, it wasn't fancy math. What it was about was asking the right questions, building language, building community, and moving from there. We really do think that there are solutions here, but we need to get really creative. We need to stop looking to other regions. We need to start answering our own questions here. And the way to do that is to look into lived experiences. The only people who understand what are happening are the people who are experiencing the marginalization every day. So for example, you know, we're looking at issues in healthcare. There are women who go to the doctor and they say, I'm having X, Y, and Z symptom, and their doctor says, I don't believe you. I'm not going to run any tests. I don't hear you, right? So what kind of interventions can we design? We can train doctors. We can look at metrics. We can look at patient outcomes. We can talk to ombudsmen. We can look at policy. We can look at punitive damages. There's so many different ways that we can combat these things. But it's about centering the actual behaviors rather than this larger, nebulous, systemic conversation. The way that we're looking at this is understanding and changing behavior. And this is kind of a groundbreaking way of looking at this. That's why Chi-Chi and I decided to structure it this way. Was to give people power and so that they could decide for us what are the best interventions. We're not going to propagate interventions. We're going to tell you what options there are and help women build on those.
Anyone else want to comment?
Yeah, to the chair, to the councilman. I think also it is like we talk much at this table often about education, school, and testing. Somehow in this city, we stop evaluating what we do. And we have to go back to evaluating what is it that we do? What are we good at? Where are we improving and moving the needle as far as black women in the economy in this city? Where are we doing as far as them moving up the ladder as far as it relates to being CEOs, being head of boards, and so forth? Our measurements just haven't been there. Somewhere we talk about this at the table, evaluation and trying to do quantitative analysis, but somewhere down the line it drops off, it fades away. So we have to be deliberate in making sure we're ensuring that we are testing the results. This is a pilot and a test, but we're going to have to keep going back out with Enlightened Solutions to make sure that we survey the women again to see if we're improving. We only know how good we are if we continue the measurements. So we have to go back to that. So even though it looks like we're failing as a city, I don't think it's a deliberate failure. I actually think it's an encouraging failure because we can start today moving forward to build this in a way to where we're more at the top of these graphs than at the bottom.
Okay. Could I have from Ms. Chambers?
Sorry, one last point.
Okay.
Another piece is after...
Go ahead.
Speaking for the children, I think we fail in the community. You know, aside from Councilwoman House, I don't know who any of you are. And I think you should be present in your wards, like as the council person, but I think we should be together, collectively, in the community and speaking to the children. And they probably don't quite understand what's going on, especially in like middle schools, but children are so easy. Like, and they're honest. So if you ask a child, you know, what do you want to see in your community? Maybe they don't have enough books. Maybe they don't have enough people to talk to, or they don't have something at their school that they want there. And they'll simply tell you that, but they don't know who you guys are. And you don't have to be like, oh, I work for the city and I'm this council person, because they don't know what you're talking about. You just have to be like, what do you want to see in the community? Or what would you like to do in your community? And if we can make it happen, we should, because a lot of children don't have that in their community. So they're running to the streets or they're running away simply because they don't have the family or anybody. So they don't know what to do, and now everybody's spiraling instead of coming together as a community and figuring out a solution. We can start with like going to a park or having cookouts. And another thing, make it brief, our rec centers. And a lot of our rec centers are not that great. We don't have a lot of like little clubs. Like, I want to start an art therapy club at the rec center. How am I going to do that without any children there? They don't know. So if we can get the word out, and I mean me and the people who work in the rec centers and the people who work at City Council, to get the word out so the children can come inside the rec centers instead of going haywire, then I think that would be great. Okay, that was all.
Awesome.
Great job. Great job.
Thank you, Councilman, President, and Committee. I was born and raised in Cleveland in the Mount Pleasant area. I attended Jane Adams Vocational High School, where I learned about the trades. And it was from my career at Jane Adams that place me in General Motors as a sewing machine operator, and then later transferring to the GM Parma plant. Several things that I've witnessed coming up is when they removed all these trades out of the schools, that was the start of the spiral. And then once we started spiraling, then I go into schools now on a career day and talk about apprenticeship programs, and the teacher or the students don't even know what I'm talking about. So there's a lack of communication right there. You know, they can't inspire to go in a direction if they know nothing about it. So we got to communicate better there. Then even with the apprenticeship programs, apprenticeships shouldn't be just non-traditional jobs. Apprenticeships can be anything now. They have apprenticeships in childcare. And then another point about that, I've been a UAW member coming right out of high school since 1974. And I found the right to organize and bring and build unions within the city is the key, because that's where your equality and wages come from, you know? And then a lot of students don't know that if you're not in a union, you're an at-will employee and you can be released for any or no reason at all. There's no equality there. And then one last thing is these contracts. When we give our city contracts, somewhere in these contracts has to be written that there's going to be minority and women hired. I can ride up and down the street and see all this construction, and I don't see a minority. And if I do see one, they're holding a flag. And they have higher skill level than a flag. And even when they get into them, it's hard to get others to train them once they get there. But still, something has to be in these contracts that guarantees that there is going to be minorities and women, and not just flag holders.
Right. Mr. Chairman, I want to thank the panelists that are here. You know, I had hoped, and with the election of Mayor Bibb, and maybe this is one of the things that I was hoping for, is that things would change around here. That this whole mindset that it is what it is,
yes,
in Cleveland is history, and this accepting this poverty, accepting despair, lack of opportunities in this city, that's gone. That's gone with the wind. And so, the only thing I would ask, Mr. Chairman, looking at the piece of legislation, because I've been here long enough to see commissions and groups and you name them, I've seen them all over the years, and I've seen, after the fact, I've asked myself, well, what did they do? What did they do? What did they accomplish? So I would hope, I'm going to make an amendment that there be a report back to council, that there be a reporting provision. Maybe quarterly is too quickly, but I'm saying there be a reporting provision back to the council as it pertains to the work of the commission. So we know what you're doing. So we know what you're looking at. Because I think there's got to be some accountability on everything that we do here at the table. And so I'm impressed. I want to thank my two colleagues for their action on this. I want to commend the mayor and his team. And I know Angie over the years, so I know what her commitment is. So I think, Mr. Chairman, I'll make that amendment if need be.
Councilman Polensic is, I cannot make a motion.
I will do that, Mr. Chairman.
So Councilman Polensic has made a motion to amend this legislation to add that we have a quarterly report on the commission?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'll make that motion that the commission report back to council on a quarterly basis as it pertains to your findings, your work, your efforts, so we can have a better understanding as it pertains to what's happening with the commission. And if there's other additional action that the council collectively needs to take.
Do I have a second?
Second, Mr. Chairman. Second.
Councilman Joe Jones has seconded the amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And again, I want to thank
the commission. And we'll make sure that please go over the amendment with the law director to make sure that we have it
accurately reflected in the notes.
Thank you.
Councilman,
I'm done, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you. Councilman Polinsik had, Councilman Conwell had a point on Councilman Polinsik's statement, just a point.
He mentioned about the African-American male leadership, and I know that even during the civil rights struggle, it was the women that pushed the civil rights movement, but when gangs started happening, they went out on the bus, or they were pushed back, and that wasn't good at all. But here's the other piece. It's what Councilwoman House was narrating through the chair to you, Councilman. When you have judicial inequality, the African-American males and African-American females are going to prison at an alarming rate. And when you have judicial inequality, so it's not just the mayors, it's not just the council members. We need to have more black females in elected positions as well as judges and prosecutors so that we can understand these things. Because here's to my point, and I'm going to end my point. When you break the family up by sending these African-American males and we don't get a chance to have a diversion program, it's the breakdown of the family. You breaking the family up. And that's what she was narrating last time. That's real stuff. And the only reason she was narrating it like that, because she has an up-close view and a genuine concern and a sensitive ear. So that judicial inequality also is what break our families up. And that's why you have 3/4 the head of the household is headed by females. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilman. Councilman Richard Starr, and then Councilman McCormick and Councilman Joe Jones. Please adhere to the time that you're allocated. Everyone, thank you.
Thank you, Council President. I will not be long. Most of my colleagues spoke on some of the things that I want to talk about, but something I would like to discuss, Chair to the panel, is as we talk about the commission, are we talking about the commission being the ones who are tasked with going out and administering this work, or are we talking a CDC or something pertaining to that organization would be the ones responsible for doing the work?
Director.
To the chair, to the councilman, right now this is an advisory group that's kind of reporting back to both the mayor's office and city council as well as the directors. If the recommendation from the commission is to create a programming, for instance, in community development, that recommendation will be going to that director as well as to see how we can implement that specific programming. Will we partner with CDCs? Absolutely, if that's, again, the recommendation once the commission has been established. So this commission is totally thriving off of the recommendations of the appointees. It's going to be their input. It's not us kind of dictating anything kind of in this internal building, but it's for them to tell us of what the sound of the neighborhoods and black women and girls want to see happen and in which departments and in which areas.
Thank you. Thank you, mm-hmm. Chief. Also, a point I would like to make is to everyone in the room, chair to everyone, is I think we mess up when we try to put CDC to do social service work.
I agree.
And I think as leaders, we need to have those people who specialize working with you to be at the table and be the ones to do the work while working with the commission. And the second point I would like to make is that commission, when we were pertaining black and brown women, we need to have a black and brown commission. We don't need nobody from another city. We don't need that to be any quote-unquote what we like to use the term diversity or diverse team. It needs to be black and brown, 12 individuals in leadership position from the city of Cleveland to be invested into that program, and then also having the commission work with the youth servant agency to go do the work that they are administering. I think we drop the ball when we have people who don't look like our children making decisions for our children or who haven't even experienced the Cleveland lived experience. And me growing up in a single parent household raised by my mom, and a point from my colleague that I would like to mention, chair to the panel, is when my father and my sisters and his siblings' father left the household because they were in the streets or they were hustling, it played a difficult point on my mom. She went from trying to nurture and be in the household to having to do all the both duties and working. So when we thinking about this commission, we need to have people who understand what it takes for our young women. I know a lot of times we hear from myself speak about the young males in the community, but then you got to think about them sisters. You got to think about how they are learning how to do basic needs on their own for the household, while making sure their siblings get into and from school, rather than the oldest sibling to the middle child, but doing motherly duties for their siblings. So we need to make sure this commission has, you know, like Councilwoman Members Gray and Councilwoman House, I applaud you, because we know this is a major issue in our neighborhoods. When you talk about the percentage of households, from the work that I've done in the past with Boys and Girls Club, 77% of the members coming to our clubs were head of household was a female.
Yes.
Was a female. But then we have males, then we have Hispanic people, or I'm not Hispanic, Caucasian people, just trying to tell us what we need in our community when they never went hungry. When they never had to figure out what they're going to make because mom was at work, and she was at work when we woke up, she was at work when we left. So we need an organization to work with our commission, and I don't want to put task or no role for my colleagues, but I think Councilwoman Members House and Gray should be hands-on on this, because they understand what we see on the grounds, even through the commission. And like my colleague, Councilman Plenzik mentioned, a quarterly report, but I would love to make sure that Councilwoman House and Gray are heavily involved, because our young women in our community need to see women from the city who are in leadership positions doing the great work to help them understand what it takes to make it out of their situation and to be able to be leaders in the community on another level, as well as taking it further. And that's just a point I had, Chair. That's all I had today.
Thank you, Councilman. Appreciate you. Councilman Kerry McCormick, and then Councilman Joe Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to set my own time to hold myself accountable to, but I will not take the whole 15 minutes, I promise you. So good morning, everyone. Good to see you both today. One of my favorite, most invigorating conversations, I think, in my career we had, I don't know, what was that, like a year and a half ago? Time kind of like melts together, but good to see you both. Mr. Chairman, I'm just going to read a quote from my friend Chi-Chi, who tweeted online recently, "Any movement that does not take into account the intersectional approach is never going to achieve true liberation," from Stephen Fullwood. "Our destinies are interconnected," is what she finished with. And I think that that is such an important sentiment when we think about this work. As Councilman Starr noted, it's important that, you know, as leaders in the community, we know when to step up and then when to support and not lead in a situation, but to support. And I think this work is so important. I commend my colleagues for crafting and introducing this, and for all of our community leaders here today to advancing this work, and understanding that in many movements throughout history, solidarity has been an important piece of support. So count me in solidarity and support and the work I can help and support with. And as Councilman Starr noted, I'll follow my colleague's lead on this really, really important work. But again, we just came off of Pride this weekend. Yeah. And we know this LGBT rights came because a whole bunch of people with a whole bunch of different backgrounds came together to support that work. And so I just wanted to say that I think it's important in solidarity and support that we really join and support this work together. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you so much, Councilman McCormick. I have Councilman Joe Jones and then Councilman Kevin Bishop. Councilman Joe Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, to the mayor of the city of Cleveland and to the commission who is assembled here to take upon themselves a worthy task. And that is trying to figure out what is the root cause that is causing for black women in the city of Cleveland to rank last place in economy and health. A class of people who, if it were not for them, we would not be where we are today. A group of black women like my mother, who took care of our family when my father worked and took care of the community. And today, black women make up 73% in terms of head of household in our communities in the city of Cleveland, and in some areas, 90%. I think that what I would ask the commission that is before, so those who would be sitting on the commission, is to look at the environments of racism and sexism in the city of Cleveland. When we start looking at what is the root cause and how to change those situations, we'll make things better. I come from a poor family, and when we were raised, we didn't even know we were poor because our family did such a great job shielding us and making sure that we had fun as kids. There was also like the young lady, and she was a breath of fresh air when she made her testimony down at the end of the table about council people getting involved in their neighborhoods and bringing the community engaged. And there was another challenge here about black leadership and where black leadership needs to be, especially in our communities. And I think that means hands-on. The young lady also talked about our recreational facilities. So it was again great to hear her talk about those recreational facilities and what they mean to our communities. How it is also a place where moms can get a break, because the kids are at these recreational facilities. And I can remember, Mr. President, going to these recreational facilities, John F. Kennedy Recreational Facility, and playing there almost all day long. So we have to look at, Mr. President, and to the bodies of council here, how we make those facilities more full-time operated. Today, young people do need a place to go. And we need to bring our community together to talk about how we do that. But more important, how we make the necessary investments in our communities that are very important. And one of those is paying women for the work that they do. Also, when it comes to contracts, we need to be real about who the real minorities are. The real minorities are black people. Black men and women. So if you can imagine, if black women are having a hard time, you can't even begin to understand where black men are. Black women are, in the 2014 study, are the most educated group in America, but also one of the most impoverished groups, one of the most stressed out groups, one of the most sickest groups, because they have their hands full on a number of levels. So I submit, Mr. Chairman, that as you begin your studies, talk about how we can reclassify what minority really means. And then make available the opportunities for our minority businesses, our female-run operated businesses, how we help them, but more important, how we get our financial institutions behind supporting our communities. When you look at any neighborhood and any community, and especially in the city of Cleveland, the reason why black women are in the last place, look at our community. When you look at our community and look at other neighborhoods, you have a night and day. It's like night and day. There's no comparison. So we have to talk about how we invest in communities. And this table can certainly do that. And this table here can certainly bring the financial institutions to the table to talk about how we re-engage and reinvest and get over this sexism and this racism. And even what troubles me even to this day, the politics on a national level in terms of preventing women from being able to make a choice as it relates to their bodies. This is a very horrible thing and a very horrible proposition that's placed upon the national stage. It also stresses all of our women out across this nation. So with that being said, Mr. President, I support this commission. I hope that this commission can work very strongly, closely together, started really nailing down on what those issues are and how we can create the necessary policies to empower, to strengthen those who have worked so hard over the years to build the very foundation that we have in the black neighborhood. So with that, Mr. President, I appreciate this commission. I thank the mayor of the city of Cleveland for his wisdom and for his oversight on being able to work with our elected officials here, Mrs. Gray and Mrs. House, for their commitment and dedication to put this legislation in play and to make this a possibility to improve the quality of life for our women, our minority women. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Councilman. Appreciate it. Councilman Kevin Bishop, and then we'll end with Councilman Anthony Hairston.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just want to take a minute to express my support for this piece of legislation. Also, I want to thank Councilwoman House and Councilwoman Gray, the mayor, Ms. Woodson, for putting this forward and putting your energy into this. This is a far has gone on far too long, and we need to support our black women in every turn. You know, black women has been victimized and discriminated and just beat down since slavery. And we any community, the most important leadership in any community is the head of the household, under each and every roof and on each and every street and each and every house, and that's the black woman in the black community. So our community has suffered because the leaders of our underneath each and every household has suffered and has struggled. So this commission, I am glad to see this commission formed, and I fully support this commission. Also want to thank Ms. Chambers for being here this morning, providing testimony. And you know, and we're looking forward to supporting black women going into the future. Thank you, Ms. Chairman.
Thank you so much, Councilman Bishop. Councilman Hairston, you had the last word.
Thank you, President Griffin. I'll be brief. I just, again, want to echo my colleagues to say that I am happy to see this commission being formed. Thank you to our colleagues, Councilwoman House and Gray, along with Mayor Bibb and his team, for working together over these past 5 months to bring this to us to vote on today. It would be a shame that we aren't, or we won't receive the coverage that we received when we made the list for being the worst place for black women. I really hope that those who are listening, the news outlets, the tweeters or the Twitter, whatever you call them, the Instagrammers, the Facebookers, all these other individuals who made it a point to share the fact that we are the worst place for black women to succeed, that they turn around and make sure that they put this out there, that we have done this work, that these two council people, the mayor and his team, have done this work to bring this forward and offer ways to be involved, to help, to move this forward, right? And as Councilman Starr said, that we need people who look like those who are trying to help to be a part of this movement, not anyone else. We talk about police and how it's important to have those who not only look like you, but understand you. And only people who understand the individuals who we are creating this commission to support are those individuals. So at the end of the day, Mr. President, thank you for bringing this forward. Thank you to our two colleagues. Thank you to the mayor, again, and his staff for seeing this through. I heard a little bit about this as our colleagues came in through the door, and happy to be support of this commission. And you know, as we go along, I know that we are waiting for the commission to come together to determine what resources they are in need of. But I hope once that decision and determination is made, that we come back to this body to ensure that they have the adequate funding they need to be successful. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you so much, Councilman Hairston. I'm actually
to clarify that about the President.
Let me say this, and I'll be real quick. The African American female, and I got to do this.
Councilman, I know, but I mean, we really. I mean, but if you could just get one quick point, and then I do want to. I have to read an amendment too on this.
And I want to put that amendment in also about the who's that? The workshops. I don't want the sisters to ever be left out again. When you look at the civil rights movement, the whole nine yards, it was African-American females that was championing that movement. Even when you look at King, it was Coretta Scott King not credit card, Scott King. It was the sister that sent out on the bus. They pushed Martin Luther King, and it was the sisters in every single movement. Fannie Lou Hamer, Coretta Scott King, the list goes on and on. And I don't want the sisters to ever be left out again. They need to be senators. They need to be even the president of the United States of America. And that's where I'm at. So thank you very much. So
thank you, Councilman. All right, I'm going to read this amendment because there was one amendment put forward, and I need to make sure that we read it into the record. It says in section one, at new section 16201, insert new division B to read as follows. The appointing authority for those described in division A above shall be as followed. The mayor shall appoint those described in subdivisions 1-4. The council shall appoint those described in subdivisions 5-8. And the mayor and council shall each appoint one student described in subdivision 9-10. And reletter existing divisions B and C to new divisions C and D. I believe this amendment was put forward by Councilwoman House. Councilwoman House, does this accurately reflect the amendment you put forward?
Yes, it does.
All right, thank you. Do I have a motion to approve that amendment?
So moved.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing no discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it. Hearing no more questions, ordinance number 373-2022 stands approved. I do want to commend my colleagues, Councilwoman House and Councilwoman Gray. This is a huge piece, and really happy to be working closely with Mayor Bibb. Thank you so much to him and his administration for this as well. Have a great day. Okay, I want to make a quick detour to acknowledge, because whenever we have members of our State House that are here, I want to make sure that we just take a moment to acknowledge them because we have so many State House members. I'm going to ask if they can all stand, and I believe the Dean of the State House is Nikki Antonio. So Nikki Antonio, let's say, give her a round of applause. Then we have, I'm going to try and go in order of seniority. I think next is Kent Smith in order of seniority. So I want to acknowledge Kent Smith. We have my good friend Juanita Brent, who is here with us as well. And then we also have my good friend Shayla Davis, who is here with us. Oops, and I miss Terrence Upchurch as well.
The best one in the
group.
Let's
give them all a round of applause. We have a very good relationship with our state delegation, so whenever they're here, I want to make sure that we embrace them. We love the work you guys are doing. As you can see, we're entrenched in our work here as well. So thank you all for coming today.
Thank you.
All right. Next up on the deck.
I'm going to hear the NYSP program next, which is ordinance number 453-2022. We always like to make sure that we hear from our guests first. So we're going to bring up the group from National Youth Sports Program, and this is by Council Members Bishop, Santana, and Griffin by departmental request. An emergency ordinance authorizing the Director of Public Works to enter into one or more contracts with Case Western Reserve University to provide a youth summer sports, nutrition, health, and life skills development program for 2022 under the National Youth Sports Program sponsored by Case Western Reserve University. We have Director Williams, and where's the rest of the crew?
They're coming over there. Overflow.
Here's Commissioner Gibson Tanner, and who else is going to join us at the table? Coach Harris is going to join us at the table. All right. Director, would you like to introduce your guests and go into this piece of legislation?
To the Council, to the Chair, I defer to Commissioner Gibson Tanner.
Good morning, Chairman. Council, our guest today from NYSP, I have Dennis Harris and Dennis Grouper, who can speak to this fabulous program that my child as well participated in years ago. Dennis Harris.
to the chair and to the great people of City Council, I'm just glad to be here. I'm here to tell you guys about hope. I listened to that great presentation that just took place with the black women. Excellent presentation. Just give you a little background about myself. I am a Clevelander. Grew up in Cleveland, went to Cleveland School, graduated from John F. Kennedy. My whole family graduated from Cleveland schools. One sister went to Jane Addams, one brother went to Max Hayes, one went to South High School, one went to Rhodes. So when you talk about education in Cleveland, I get it. I went to Cleveland Beehive, Charles W. Elliott, John F. Kennedy, The Ohio State University, played football for the Buckeye, my team went to the Sugar Bowl, Gator Bowl, and Rose Bowl. I was a teacher in Cleveland. I taught at Cleveland College Schuler, John F. Kennedy, South High School. So this whole thing about education, I get it. Education is something that's important to me. Education can solve a lot of the problems. I'm very fortunate. I've been working at Case Western Reserve this summer, make 40 years. I live in Cleveland, Ohio. I grew up, was born in Ward 1. Is it Mr. Jones here?
Yes, sir.
Oh, Mr. Jones, grew up in your great ward.
Yes, sir.
And I've been living in Ward 2 for 34 years in Ward 2, but every ward in Cleveland I've been involved with. I love the city of Cleveland. I am, like I said, born here in Cleveland, taught in Cleveland, and still live in Cleveland. I'm a grandparent, and my kids and grandkids in Cleveland. I'm here representing a program, the National Youth Sports Program, that I am so proud of. This summer will make 52 years on the campus of Case Western Reserve University. As a little boy growing up, I would have loved to be in a program like Case Western Reserve National Youth Sports Program. When I graduated from Ohio State University, I get the thing about sports. You know, I've been fortunate, you know, like I said, as an athlete, I play sports. And when I came on Case Western Reserve campus, I said, wait a minute. We got chemistry professors, engineers, doctors, lawyers, you name it. That's what I expose our kids to. This morning is the first day of camp, and I was there at 7 o'clock this morning, and you should have seen the hope in those kids' eyes, the hope in the parents dropping them off. That's why I'm here right now to tell you about hope. I hear about the negative things, what goes on in Cleveland, but Cleveland is coming up. Is Mr. Plinsic here?
No, he stepped out.
I call him, he's one of my heroes. I call him the Clint Eastwood of Cleveland Council because he has that fire, what life is about. And bring Clint Eastwood, you're laughing over there, Norman Casey. When you see him, call him, there's Mr. Plinsic. I'll just call him, he's the Clint Eastwood of not just a Cleveland City Council, of the country. He has that fire, that spark. I'm gonna tell you something, Mr. Plinsic. Many times I come out of council, you guys, I just come down and I just sit and I watch you guys. I've been doing this for over 20, just coming down to City Council for over 25 years, watching you guys fighting for Cleveland. Miss House, there, Ward, you know, you've called me, come to school, co-chairs, I need you, come. That's what this is about. We cannot give up on Cleveland. I will not give up on Cleveland. That's why I'm right here, right now. Dennis Rupert is my supervisor, and he knows how I fight at that university since 1982 to give our kids the even playing field for our program. We have at that university a chance to make a difference in kids' life, and I've seen it. I've seen more doctors, lawyers, engineers, athletes come out of that program because we teach them love, hope, and what's on the back of my shirt, we teach them respect, and I think that's what's missing. Dennis Rupert, you want to take it?
And I'm going to ask everybody to keep in mind, we have about 60 pieces of legislation today. I want to make sure that I can try to keep us on track. And I know that these are important programs and everybody's very passionate, but I want to make sure I make that everybody aware of that. So if we can go ahead. Go ahead.
Thank you, Council. We're here today to really continue a legacy of a program from Case Western Reserve and the National Youth Sports Program. And, you know, it has been a longstanding partnership with the council and the Department of Recreation in providing a safe and instructional program. Coach Harris has taken what we started back in 1970 and turned it into not just a sports program, but a program that educates our kids, teaches them respect, helps them understand, you know, that they are a very important voice in the community, in their, you know, in their education and in their experience, that we engage them on an ongoing basis to be able to give back and give to one another. I'm not going to take a long time here. I just want to, you know, thank you for your ongoing support of this program through the years. Again, you know, the institution has a breadth of experience in not only staff like Coach Harris, but in the faculty members and the staff who work with the program. Coach also recruits an amazing staff every year to work with these kids so that they're getting prime instruction and great expertise. And so I actually would just turn it over to you sure. And, you know, ask us any questions.
We'll turn it over to my colleagues for questions. Just very briefly, all three of my sons have gone through the program. A lot of the young people in the neighborhood have gone through the program. Most people's children in City Hall has gone through a program. This is just a great program. So, Coach, thank you so much. I know what it consists of. I want to make sure I turn it over to a couple of my colleagues. So I have Councilman Joe Jones and Councilman Kevin Bishop. Councilman Joe Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. You guys do a really wonderful job with that program. I can recall some years back, before I got on the council, my son was looking at participating in the program. And I just want to thank the coach. I'm glad you grew up and born, bred, raised in the Lee Harbor Ward 1 area. And I do have some questions, and one of them is, in terms of participation, how do you get the word out?
Coach.
First of all, I almost
once again, please everybody come through the chair deck so we can facilitate the meeting appropriately.
Through the chair. I've been to almost every school in Greater Cleveland. I've been to churches. I do. I've been did food banks, organizations, committee meetings. You see me everywhere, so I get the word out. About the program. You know, I live in Cleveland. I'm everywhere: east side, west side, northeast side, southeast side. That's what I do to get the word out.
Well, we'd love to after the session get with you so we could put a piece out in the neighborhood and make sure that we can let young folks know that the program and parents know that it is available.
Thank you, Councilman.
And then second, Mr. Chairman, I will be brief, how many young people participate in your program on an annual basis?
This year we'll have 300 kids. 300 kids, and we participate in the program. And we also get the parents to participate. So I'm dealing with over 600 people right now on campus.
So is 300 a cutoff?
That is correct, sir.
So how do if one wants to participate, how do they get into the program that cutoff date?
Well, we send flyers out to everywhere. I think we even sent to your office about that. I think Councilman Bishop, he put in his newsletter about the program. So I think he's sending out to all the councilmen about the program.
No further questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you to the coach and to Case Western for the great job that you guys do.
Thank you, Councilman Jones. Councilman Kevin Bishop.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I just want to commend the Case Western Reserve and the NYSP program and the coach. You do a great job, and we look forward to years and years of continued service to our children and our communities through our children. All right, that's all I want to say, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you so much, Councilman Bishop. Seeing no more questions, ordinance number 453-2022 stands approved. Please sign on. Coach, keep up the great work.
And thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen,
thank you, Chairman.
Keep up the great work.
Thank
all right,
you.
We're going to move now to... We're going to move now to... And now, once again, I want to just remind my colleagues, we have a lot of legislation that is going on the agenda today. We need to make sure that we hear these pieces of legislation. These have gone through committee. So keep that in mind. And I've brought up our guests first. So now we're going to have Economic Development 544-2022 from Economic Development. And I believe Director Thornton has guests that are going to join him at the table with us today.
Which one is this, Mr. Chairman?
This is 544-2022 in the Economic Development. Thank you. Director.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. This morning I have Ann Hartness, and she has a few guests, which I would like them to be able to introduce themselves.
Sure. Please speak into the microphone, and please get them a microphone.
Do you want me to go first or introduce? Good morning. Thanks for having us here today. My name is Ann Hartnett. I am here with you today to ask for your support for our loan to provide the final funding for our project at 2915 Detroit Ave. I want to thank Councilman McCormick for all of his efforts in getting us here today. The property will be acquired with a mortgage from Huntington Bank in first position, and the leasehold improvements are being proposed with a joint loan, a joint position, one loan from the City of Cleveland, which the Economic Development team will speak to, and an additional loan from Cuyahoga County. I'm the founder of Harness Cycle, a movement studio in the Ohio City neighborhood. We've been open since 2013 when I first opened my doors. It started my journey as an entrepreneur in the City of Cleveland. While my business has been successful, generating over $5 million in revenue since 2013 and well over $1 million in payroll to predominantly Cleveland residents, what I'm most proud of is the impact and energy we've brought to the corridor of Ohio City, now known as Hingetown. It is through this impact on the neighborhood that I realize my business is not only a strong, small, locally owned business, but it's also a real estate asset. It's a market driver. I watched the value of real estate, of commercial property and homes skyrocket around me since opening our doors. We signed our lease at $9 a square foot, and currently the going market rate in that neighborhood is $35 a square foot. So while there was economic growth, I also watched the diversity and equity around ownership decrease. Small business owners getting priced out, and developers, the number of developers decreasing because investors and developers were buying up properties, increasing profit margins, and often excluding those that were existing in the neighborhood. It was through this firsthand experience 8 years ago that I became interested in exploring and development for my business as well as other small businesses. But of course, 2020 had other plans. In March of 2020, I closed my business doors in response to the rising cases of COVID-19 in the United States, just a few days before it was mandated by the governor. Committed to continuing to remain closed in the best interest of my neighborhood, but also pay rent, loans, and operating expenses, I quickly pivoted to a multitude of solutions, one being subleases for my storefront. I thought that it was important not only to continue to make payments, but also to have occupancy in a storefront in a critical component of our neighborhood's vibrancy. So in July of 2020, not many leases were getting signed in the City of Cleveland. Cases were spiking, and we weren't sure when this pandemic was going to end. I had a relationship with Lululemon Athletica as a retailer of their activewear. They're headquartered in Vancouver, and prior to the pandemic, had been seeking a storefront in the city. I reached out to the headquarters and asked if they would be interested, despite the pandemic, in subleasing my storefront. They came out, and they said they would for a year. Of course, that meant we would be closed, but it was my first experience in becoming a landlord. We were able to activate the storefront, and I was able to cover my costs and continue paying rent, never missing a rent payment despite our closure. After Lululemon lease ended last fall, I realized that the heart and soul of our neighborhood is locally owned businesses. Of course, we were thrilled to have a national retailer, but the community really desires locally owned businesses. So the next step was to work with two aspiring brick and mortar entrepreneurs and work with them to not only operate in their storefront, but I coach them weekly to experience success, overcome hurdles, and gain traction in the neighborhood. So not only had I become, due to the pandemic, a landlord, but now I started consulting other small businesses to use the experience I've had over the last 9 years, share my playbook, and help them to be successful from day one as well. So that leads us to about a year ago. 2915 Detroit Ave, just one door west of our first location, became available for sale. It's a large building, 18,000 square feet, and will comprise of six retail operators. I will be the owner of this property and also an occupant. Harness Cycle will be the core tenant. I have with me today two of our other tenants in this project. I'd like to introduce you first to Yolanda Rosenthal Green.
If I could, I apologize because this has been heard in DPS, and I do want to make sure that I acknowledge comments from Councilman McCormick, but for the sake of time, if we could just announce yourself who you are, and then we'll go through the couple of the remarks from the supporting council people, and then we'll move on, okay?
Great. Thank you. My name is Yolanda Rosenthal Green. I will be operating the yoga studio that will be inside, housed inside of the building.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you so much.
Great. And I'm Marie Artali. I'm going to be operating the all-day cafe and aperitivo bar at the front of the building on Detroit Avenue.
Awesome. It seems like an awesome project. I'm going to start out. This was heard in the development planning and sustainability. Councilman Harrison, do you have any comments on this?
Thank you, Mr. President. My comments will be brief. Yes, we've heard this extensively last week in DPS committee. It passed out of committee with full support. As we heard from the administration that the project itself, the property itself, value supports the loan requests from the city. The Huntington back support and other resources they are looking to obtain. I know there were some questions around that issue, but we felt comfortable we passed this, and we asked for my colleague's support. Thank you.
Great, thank you. The local councilman who enthusiastically supports this, Councilman McCormick.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I will be brief and not use my whole comments I did last time at DPS, but thank you. I just want to thank, first of all, Mayor Bibb's team and the economic development team for your hard work on this, the county, as well as Huntington Bank. In a world in which we talk a lot about what banks aren't doing, Huntington really stepped up to fund this 100% female and minority-owned development. I don't know the last time we saw a development that came to the table with those statistics. So I am very, very excited for these young entrepreneurs, exciting entrepreneurs in our community, to be launching this business together. This is rehabilitating an important building in the community. And again, I will tell you from experience, Mr. Chairman, a lot of times the developers that come in front of us look like me. So it's good to have a fresh set of faces that are taking ownership in our community, not just as a tenant, but really starting businesses, owning buildings. So we're very, very excited about this collection of businesses that are going to be moving into Ohio City, creating jobs, creating economic vitality. What's in front of us today, Mr. Chairman, is a loan product to help support the businesses that are in there. And again, Huntington Bank is taking the majority of the lending here from the private sector, and the county and the city are partnering to ensure that this business gets off the ground. But again, as I said in committee, Mr. Chairman, this is exactly, as we talk about at the finance table, about ensuring that we're investing in diverse businesses in our community, that we're investing in businesses that might not have tens of millions of dollars sitting in the bank. You know, these, we talk about that a lot. Now we have one in front of us. And so I appreciate my colleagues' support for this really exciting collection of businesses that we'll be launching in the city of Cleveland. And really enthusiastically support this. And Ms. Hartnett, please remember Councilman Harrison needs that invitation when you open your doors. Don't forget that. He made that very clear. But again, Mr. Chairman, great collection of small businesses, 100% female minority owned.
You beat me to it because I was going to say we all need to make sure we have an invitation when you open up your doors. It sounds
consider
very
it done.
Exciting.
Mr. Chairman.
So thank you. Seeing no more questions.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilman Jones.
Yes, please. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, looking at this project, the question I have, Mr. Chairman, to the director, we're looking at a $2.8 million project. Is that correct?
Through the chairman, to the councilman, yes.
Okay. And in the project of $2.8 million, what's the breakdown? Who's helping to pay for that cost? I know that the city has this loan here, but I don't have any other presentations in front of me that gives us a breakdown. How much is Huntington Bank putting on this project?
Huntington Bank is putting in $1.580 million.
Normally, Mr. Chairman, to the Director of Economic Development, the Assistant Director, is always a breakdown. It gives the council an idea who's how the whole project is put together and who has what position. How does that rank out here? Do you have an executive piece of paper that can explain that to us? Yep.
To the council person, to the chairperson, to the council person, the financing that is here is the bank, Huntington Bank, which is mentioned, is for $1,580,000. Then will come the City of Cleveland for $646,700.
You have that in writing, Mr. Chairman. Normally, you guys usually are good at bringing that to the table, and I just don't want you to start slipping. Now, I see this on this project right here. I've seen future, you know, previous projects where it had a breakdown. It gives us a better idea if the what's being invested is going to be returned.
I want to do this one more time because I want to make sure that everybody runs the questions through the chair so that we don't interrupt with each other. I want to make sure that we continue to do that. So the councilman has put in a request. I just don't want the conversation to go back and forth if we can always go through the chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So, Mr. Chairman, to the director, do you have an executive portfolio that you would always bring to the table to show us how all of the processes work?
Through the chairman, to the councilman, yes, we do.
And we will.
So can we make sure that we provide that to Mr. Titran, and we'll make sure that the councilman gets that? He would like to see that.
And Mr. Chairman, in the meantime, since the director is unprepared in his presentation, if Mr. Smosser could move forward and tell us that breakdown, please.
Mr. Smosser, can you repeat that breakdown, please?
Most certainly. To the chairperson, to the councilman. The bank is in at Huntington Bank for $1,580,000. The City of Cleveland is in it for $646,700. And Cuyahoga County is coming in with $485,000 loan. And the equity from Ann Hartnett, who is here at the table, is coming in at $169,700 for a total of $2,881,400.
And the money that we're given to the loan, Mr. Chairman, to the director is out of what loan account?
It will be.
Could you speak in the microphone?
Through the chairman, to the councilman, it'll be UDAG repayments.
So this will be a UDAG repayment. So, Mr. Chairman, to the director, is this, because I know that sometimes we have the UDAG repayment, but then it just, you know, they don't pay it back, it is forgiven. Is this one of those kind of economic situations, Mr. Chairman, to the director?
Director.
Through the chairman, to the councilman, there is a loan with an interest rate, and there is a payback.
I see. So it, has there been, Mr. Chairman, to the assistant director, where we have loaned out of the UDAG account and then forgiven those loans?
To the councilman, through the chairman, to the councilman, I've only been here like a little over 45 days, so I can't tell you what historically has been done. I can tell you going back much further than 2015, we had a variety of ways in which we funded projects and forgave loans and put loans off for 2 or 3 years to allow businesses to, you know, build themselves up to the point where they could pay debt service.
I see. And Mr. Chairman, you know, finally, I heard the young lady talk about, you know, what was going to be in there. I think it's yogurt.
Yes.
So that's exciting. How big, how many square foot space is it?
I'll speak to the full project. So there's 6 retail spaces. Harness Cycle Indoor Cycling is the primary tenant. Yolanda will be operating the yoga studio. Marie will be operating our food and bev. We have a co-working space, a children's stay and play, which will be children's programming, as well as a member's spa in the basement.
You're going to have a spa down there, too?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's excellent. So, Mr. Chairman, this sounds like a great deal. I want to, again, I concur. I think, Carrie McCormick, this is a nice piece in the community. Is this your first yoga place in the neighborhood, Mr. Chairman?
No, sir.
How many yoga spots do you have?
Through the chair to the councilman, I don't have that off the top of my head.
So I hope that it's affordable. Yoga is really good, and once you get open, when is your time of, when do you look to open up, Ms. Ann?
Harness Cycle will be open, we're shooting for October, and the other entities will have around a 4 to 6 month lead time for their build outs.
Mr. Chairman, to the director, to you all, great success. Godspeed.
Thank you.
I look forward to coming down there. I know one thing, I'm going to be checking out the yoga classes when they start. So are you going to look at doing that, Mr. Chairman? When is that going to get started?
Can you have a council yoga night?
Sure.
Absolutely.
For Joe Jones,
absolutely.
Council yoga night. Yoga.
That's right. Yeah. So, Mr. Chairman, no further questions. Thank you,
Councilor. Thank you so much. Seeing no more questions, ordinance number 544-2022 stands approved. We wish you the best.
Thank
Looking
you very
forward
much.
To working with you guys.
Thank you.
I'm going to ask safety to opening. Come to the table. Once again, I'm going to share with my colleagues, we have a lot of legislation to get through. A lot of these were heard in committee. If we have clarifying questions, that's great. I want to make sure we always allow questions, but we do want to make sure that we are expeditious as possible. Thank you. Mr. Coulter.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you.
Mr. Gordon. All right, doing great. So the first ordinance is ordinance number 526-2022 by council members Polinsic and Griffin by departmental request, an emergency ordinance to amend sections 451-03 and 459.11 of the codified ordinances of Cleveland, Ohio, 1976, as amended by ordinance number 656-17, passed October 16, 2017, and ordinance number 1693-06, passed October 9, 2006, relating to statutory prohibiting standing or parking places and parking infractions fines. Director.
Good morning, Council President, Council members. CO section 459.11 would be amended to add a parking fine of $150 for violating the new division of CO section 451.03 as discussed previously. This fine will be for any violation of this section. We believe these amendments will deter individuals from parking in these areas during the restricted hours, which will reduce the hazard to pedestrians, improve traffic flow, and will allow better emergency vehicle access when needed during these events during the restricted hours. Commissioner Gordon Holmes is with me. We're happy to take any questions.
Commissioner Holmes.
Good morning, everyone. This really, I want to say the genesis of this, for me at least, started a few years ago. I think Councilman McCormick was either new or just appointed, when the horse fell down in the flats. And we had a double event at the Q and Progressive Field. So we had about 75,000 people in downtown Cleveland. I had to ride on the sidewalk with my motorcycle to get to the accident where the horse was. I realized that you know, the parking was out of control. Former Commissioner Muick and I and Commissioner Mavick met with Councilman McCormick. We kind of developed a plan for the flats and the warehouse district. We a couple years later, we went back, we revisited it. It was started at till 10 or didn't, it ended at 8 or started at 8. We pushed it back to 8. We realized there was two different people coming into the flats. One came in for the dinner crowd, the other came in to party. So what we couldn't do on that night, we couldn't get a safety vehicle down into the flats. So everything that we do, at least in the Bureau of Traffic and the Division of Police, is about safety. So we can't get, with the ever-growing population in downtown, the visitors that are coming, all the events that we have, it has become overwhelming, and we want to make sure that we're able to move the traffic, but also get fire and EMS to anyone that needs it. Really, that's the genesis of this for me. And lately, I think in the last year, so this is about the time of the NFL draft till the end of May, we've written about 12,940 parking tickets for the special events. We've towed about 1,576. So it's about a little more than 12% tow rate. And the issue isn't we can tow every car. That's not what I'm trying to say. It's just our people in the traffic unit are tasked with towing these cars. And instead of, you know, paying attention to the event, we're towing these cars. So what I hope this is going to do is deter people from parking there, because they'd rather pay the $25 fine and than pay to park in the lots. I've been to a lot of major cities for sporting events, from Los Angeles to New York City. There's no parking anywhere around these venues because they need to get safety vehicles in. And at the end of the day, that's what this really is about.
Okay. All right. So we have several questions for this ordinance. And I'm going to start off first and foremost with the chair of Public Safety, Mike Polinsic, then Councilman McCormick, and Councilman Starr.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, my honorable colleagues. As I said to the safety director, give me an example. I'm not clear on what you're proposing. So you're telling me, you're telling us at the table that right now, if I park somewhere where there's a special event, and you're saying special event, there's signs, you're telling me there's signs posted. See, I'm not clear. That's why I said the safety to bring something over, some explanation sheet as it pertains, because this did not come before committee.
Okay. Through the chair to the councilman. Just around, we'll take Gateway as an example. Prospect Avenue from Ontario to East 9th Street, East 9th Street from Euclid to Bolivar, is Commissioner Mavic goes out weekly. There's a big orange sign. It says no parking, and then it has a placard on it, and it has specific dates and times. That's done so that we give notice so that people, you know, we're not dropping these the day of. If we have a dual event, sold out concert, sold out Indians game, we may take that out to East 14th and Prospect. But that's really what it is. If you want, I can take a picture of it and send it to you. But it's say you have a councilmatic event and you need the street cleared, we would use those signs for that, for any type of special event. Like the flats are also with those orange and white placard signs.
So, Mr. Chairman, to the commissioner, this is only for special events.
Yeah, this section would only be used for special events. Now, the only thing I will say is, on East 9th Street, we do have that rush hour restriction. But early in the year, the Indians play, you know, during the week, maybe, I'm sorry, Guardians, I apologize. They play sometimes a 1 o'clock game. So that parking, that orange placard would override anything else that's there.
So then, Mr. Chairman, to the director, acting director, and to the commissioner, how did you determine $150 fine?
Through the chair to the councilman, I don't know. That was at the director and the chief's level.
Director?
There were, I will defer that to the director. However, the fine was determined to be, what we have now is people willing to pay $25 because they know that finding parking is that's an alternative to finding an open parking. So the fine was increased with the intent of encouraging people to find legal parking and not acquiescing to just paying a fee, which in some instances is considered nominal to what they would potentially pay or the distance that they would have to walk from a legal parking spot.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, to the acting director, is there a reason why the director's not here?
The director is in a previous engagement, and okay. We're happy to direct any questions
okay.
or answer any questions.
Well, Mr. Chairman, this is my comment. $150 seems to be pretty steep. Seems to be pretty steep. Is there any other traffic offense, parking offense that's $150 for a parking offense that you can tell us?
Through the chair to the councilman, not that I'm aware of. But councilman, I caution everyone at the table to look at this not as a monetary thing, but if you had been down there that night or any night where we're just completely jammed, we cannot get a fire truck through. We cannot get an EMS truck through. The only thing we can get through is motorcycles on the sidewalk. That's not the best answer, you know, that we have to do that. But we're weighing $150 or the cost of somebody maybe losing their life and things like that. And I'm not minimizing your question. I look at everything from a safety point of view. Can we move traffic? Can we get the safety vehicles in and out? If you've ever been in the flats on a busy night, you know the answer is it's difficult at best.
Through the chair to the council, councilperson, $150 is equivalent to a minor misdemeanor fine.
I understand that. I'm just trying to figure out. You know, I hear your concern. I hear your issues. On the other side of the coin, we want people to come downtown. We want people to come downtown without getting creamed, okay? So I hear your concern about people who are parking illegally. I just have a question as it pertains to $150 versus maybe $100 for parking.
You know, Director, there's a lot of apprehension on this one. I'm going to hold this piece. I'm going to hear from a couple more folks, but I'm going to hold this piece, and then I want to make sure we refer it back to safety and have a little bit further vetting on this, okay? So we're going to hold this piece
if we could.
I know that Councilman McCormick wanted to make a brief remark, and I'm going to ask if everyone else, we probably
I'll
don't
be
need
brief
to
too.
Have, yeah. Well, we're holding it. So if I could, can we actually wait until we take it to public safety instead of debating a conversation?
That's fine, Mr. Chairman.
It was a point of order on this piece.
Okay, I will let both of you guys have a point. Now, I just want to
Mr. Chairman, this heavily affects my ward, and I've never heard of this piece. Mm-hmm. So I would recommend to the Division of Public Safety that you come to us when you're going to have a piece that dramatically impacts our wards. It is already, I'm really concerned about, I think we need to have a larger conversation about parking in downtown. Because the 1,000 cars that we've towed are tourists that come and spend money downtown. They're residents downtown. And I understand this public safety. We've got to balance that. I agree with that. However, those people aren't coming back downtown. They're not coming back into the city of Cleveland. When their car, when they leave, come out of dinner and their car is gone. So we have to have a bigger conversation here. I would have been a strong no vote on this piece if it went out to committee today. But please engage with the local council people that are going to hear about this prior to it coming to the table.
And I dare to say, even though I know that it affects the local councilman, this councilman made an eloquent point, it affects the whole city. And we're the ones that get those calls when constituents go down there and they kind of get caught in this mix, and that's huge. So Councilman Joe Jones, you had a point. But
Mr. Chairman, just you know, when you come back, I know it's going to come back to the table. If you could make available to us the information of where it's going to be targeted and impact would be important, one. And then also, two, if you're going to talk about doing something like that and you put the signs out, you ought to put on there $150 fine. So the people know automatically that before they get ready and park right there where you have that sign listed, it says $150 fine.
Good point.
On that point.
Here's the thing. With the to the chair, to the councilman, when you reach out to the councilman over there and you mention, I don't know your name, sir.
Commissioner Holmes.
Commissioner, tell Councilmember McCormack that when you mentioned how this is working in Los Angeles, just give him some data. Let him know that it hurt business, because I don't want to hurt business and I want to save people's lives. Let him know what happened, because you got a snapshot of lessons learned. You know, you see what I'm saying, Councilman. And you could let the Councilmember Mike Palencia know also what were the pros and what was the cons of this legislation in Los Angeles and other cities that you just mentioned. So don't just come to the table saying it worked there. but show the outcome measures. Thank you.
So this is going to be vetted in safety committee. So, Councilman,
Mr. President, I know. Can I respond to that, please?
Say that again.
Can I respond to that?
Please proceed.
Through the chair to the councilman, I never said that anything about legislation in Los Angeles. What I did say was I've been in sporting venues from Los Angeles to New York City, and there's no parking anywhere around the arena. That's what I said. If you misunderstood, I'm sorry. If I misspoke, I'm sorry. But I would like to also say to the committee here that everywhere we put these signs, there's stickers on the parking meters that say, please, you know, there's restrictions, please follow the signs. So this isn't arbitrary. It's around the sporting venues, and it's late at night in the flats, or if someone had a councilmatic event that we needed to clear the road, it would be used for that. This isn't, it's two streets, Prospect, 9th Street, and Huron, I'm sorry, 3, and then West 9th and Old River Road mostly, and St. Clair during the warehouse and hours and the flats hours. So, but I understand everyone's concerns, and I mean.
And Commissioner, we do understand that you know, are erring on the side of safety. I think having a full vetting through Public Safety Committee is why this is really needed, because maybe after you go through Public Safety, there will be a better understanding. So just want to make sure we have that.
Not
okay?
a problem.
All right, thank you.
Certainly.
Next, we're going to hear Ordinance Number 529-2022 by Council Members Polinsic and Griffin, by departmental request, an emergency ordinance authorizing the Director of Public Safety to enter into one or more agreements with various colleges, universities, or other entities that provide training and instruction for veterinary technician, and other professions relating to animal care for the city to provide internships and externships to students in exchange for their services at no cost to the city, for the Division of Animal Care and Control, Department of Public Safety, for a period not to exceed 1 year, with two options to renew not to exceed 1 year each, exercisable by the Director of Public Safety. Director.
Thank you, Council President. We believe this is an opportunity to provide students studying to be veterinarians, veterinarian technicians, and other professionals relating to animal care to receive useful real-world experience providing these services to animals provided for by the city's Division of Animal Care and Control. It is also an opportunity for us to show the students the opportunities that exist within the city for those who are interested in future employment. We believe this program will be mutually beneficial to the students and to our Division of Animal Care and Control. With us this morning is Corey Keller, our Director of Animal Care and Control. He can provide some additional details as well as help us answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Keller.
Good morning, Council.
Please proceed.
What I would like to say is that this piece of legislation is extremely important to animal care and control. I'm very excited for it. It's going to give not only college students, but high school students an opportunity to really see what animal care and control can do. You know, anything from, you know, as AD Coulter has mentioned, vet tech, registered vet techs, but also animal care workers and beyond. So at Animal Care and Control, we're really excited to have something like this come through, because we'll be able to collaborate and partner with other colleges like Valley College, like Stotzenberg College, and also area high schools to really showcase the field of animal care control, and, you know, really develop the next leaders in animal welfare.
Okay, thank you. All right, I have two questions, but I'm going to first defer to the chair, Councilman Polesi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, the director had asked that this be relieved of the committee, and I supported it, and I support the legislation. The only thing I would ask is that, and I concur, I think this is, I quite frankly thought we had already had something like this in place, you know, partnerships and where, you know, et cetera, with other learning institutions. I would only ask that there be correspondence directed to CMSD, officials' correspondence, so that the school district understands that you know, we're, if there's students or people, students within a Cleveland Public School System who would like to volunteer as well, that they have that ability and that opportunity. So, Mr. Chairman, other than that, I support the legislation.
Thank you. I have Councilman Starrett and Councilman Jones.
Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Council President. I just want to reiterate for this ordinance, 529-2022, I want to recuse myself. I do not support any pieces of safety ordinance or legislations coming up before council. One, without being vetted by the safety committee. And then two, I don't support any other pieces until we address deployment strategies and juvenile analysis related to safety issues.
Please, Councilman, tonight on the floor, you'll be able to mark yourself as a no vote on this, because this is really coming through the Finance Committee. But tonight, please note that Councilman will mark himself as a no. Thank you. All right.
Mr. Chairman.
We have Councilman Joe Jones.
Mr. Chairman, to the director, you know, my colleague Mike Polinsik hit it on the nail as relates to making sure that we involve our educational system in the city of Cleveland. So I don't have any further questions, Mr. Chairman, just to restate that. And I think that this is really good that you're going to start bringing in internship and starting bringing young folks in. And that could also be a pool where you can start having more people to hire and bring in. So, Mr. Chairman, no under readiness. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Hearing no more questions, ordinance number 529-2022 stands approved.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There you go. All right. Now we're going to bring up community development. Is community development here? Assistant Director Wackers.
Good morning.
All right. This is ordinance number 531-2022 from Community Development by Councilmembers Harrison and Griffin by departmental requests and emergency ordinance notifying Council of the final budget allocations received from HUD for the 2022 Community Development Block Grant, Home Investment Partnerships Action Grant, Emergency Solutions Grant, and Housing Opportunities for Persons with AIDS Grant, and to amend Section 3 of Ordinance Number 120-2022, passed February 14, 2022, relating to the grants. Director.
Yes, thank you, Council President and members of the Committee of the Whole. This is an update, an amendment to the legislation that was passed by Council back in February. These are the final allocations that we received from HUD about 2 weeks ago. Of the four entitlement grants that we received, two were increased, one was decreased, and the fourth was zero change. So the CBG funds that we received, we know we're getting $21,125,150. This is an increase of a little more than $16,000 over what was estimated. The home funding, we were receiving a $5,331,747 grant. This is an increase of $439,000 over what was estimated. And the emergency solutions grant, we're getting $1,839,879. This is a decrease of $12,000 over what was estimated. These three amounts are being applied to the budget in three areas. The $16,000 in CDBG funding will go to the admin general administration to help support and run the programs in the department. The home funds are going into the housing trust fund, and then finally the $12,000 decrease is being applied to the continuum of care support that addresses homelessness throughout the city of Cleveland. So those are the three changes. Happy to answer any questions, but these were fully vetted.
Thank you so much. This was fully vetted and heard in DPS. Councilman Harrison, you good?
Thank you, Mr. President. Yes, fully vetted in DPS and heard. Very minor change to what we passed during the CDBG hearings. As I said, the director and his staff were spot on. Asked for approval. Thank you.
All right. Seeing or hearing no more questions, ordinance number 531-2022 stands approved. Please sign on.
Yep. Thank you.
All right, next is building and housing here. Building and housing? Not here? Okay, finance. All right. All right, we have I think I'm missing one for you, Director. I have A373, 525, and 540, but I don't see A373. Do we have that anywhere? Amended 373. Is that already passed? Or?
Yes.
What was that, Commission?
Yes.
Okay, all right. So we already got that done. Okay, thank you. Okay, Director, I know that we have another piece that we're gonna deal with, but the first one we have is ordinance number 525-2022 by Councilmember Griffin by departmental request, an emergency ordinance to make additional appropriations of $7,932,236 to the Special Revenue Fund. Director, can you go over what this means and what this is for?
Yes, through the chair to the committee of the whole. So this is a companion piece with ordinance number 547-2022, which will be heard today as well. And it is to transfer the funds needed for capital and emergency repairs at Cleveland Brown Stadium that we are required to pay for under the lease with the Browns.
Was that in our budget?
Okay. All right.
Mr. Chairman, I have a question.
I know there's going to be a few questions on this.
I have a question too, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, we will put you down. Just a couple of questions that I have before I go to my colleagues. Can you explain there, is this part of an annual repair request that we have for our stadium, or can you just explain how we came up with this 7.9 number?
Yeah, so through the chair to the committee, under the lease, the city agreed to a capital repair schedule through which the city was required to contribute certain dollars per year through the end of the lease in 2028. Over the early parts of the lease, there were not a lot of capital repairs that were needed. The stadium was brand new, and the schedule reflected that. Over the years, there have been added capital needs at the stadium. And to sort of accommodate the need, the repairs that are needed at any moment in time, we've pre-funded certain amounts. So say we owed, under the lease, $1 million in 2015, but they had $5 million of repairs to do. We would front the total amount and then credit that against future contribution obligations. So with this amount, we will have exhausted the dollars that are required to be contributed under the lease for capital repairs. And this is an annual process that we do go through with the Browns, where they provide us a request of repairs or a list of repairs, and then the folks in MoCap vet those requests. They do site visits, speak with the architect that consults with the Browns, and gets a sense of whether they are legitimate repairs that the city is responsible for or not. And then based on MoCap's advice, we then coordinate with the Browns on what the repairs will look like.
So the city does have veto power, or they do have negotiation at the table to say, to make sure that these are necessary improvements and not something that is just a wish list by the leaseholder, which is the Browns.
Yes, so through, to the chair, that's absolutely correct. Okay. The city is responsible generally for two types of repairs at the stadium, emergency repairs and capital repairs, and those are defined in the lease. And so when we, for this round of requests, when we got the lists from the team, we did a lot of vetting, about a couple months worth of back and forth with the Browns to really understand what the repairs were. I know MoCap staff visited the stadium, did a tour, and the ultimate conclusion was that the requests were, they satisfied the requirements of the lease. As capital repairs and emergency repairs.
Okay. Who picks the person doing the repairs? And who has the authority to pick the person that's doing the repairs?
Yep. So Carter Edmond from MoCap has just joined, and I think he's probably better equipped to answer that than I.
Please address, what's your name again, sir?
My name is Carter Edmond. I'm the manager of the Division of Architecture and Site Development.
Welcome, Mr. Edmond. So who picks the contractor and the person at the table? And does the city have any input in
that selection? The city does. So this is typically done one of two ways. Either the city contracts it through the regular contracting process through the Division of Purchases and Supplies, or the Browns hold the contract themselves. When the Browns hold the contract, they do comply with city OEO participation goals, and the our division, the City of Cleveland, has the opportunity to review the bids and sign off on the bid award. Even if the Browns are executing the work, our division is very involved in reviewing drawings, doing QA, observing construction, signing off on pay applications, and so forth.
So has a contractor been, a prime contractor been picked for this project already?
This is going to be multiple projects. So we've walked through the stadium and observed all the different conditions that are identified here. So there will be different contractors for different work. The fire alarm project, for example, that's going on right now, which I believe is Johnson Controls, that design was vetted through our division, and we signed off on the award of that contract.
Well, you know, Director, one of the reasons I'm asking these questions is because the name of this committee is now Finance, Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. And one of the things that we're looking at is how do we make sure that we have these this information on the front end and not on the back end? And the reason why I'm mentioning these questions and have somewhat some concerns because I want to understand diversity, equity, and inclusion numbers. And right now, we're kind of going on faith, but we don't have any facts. And we want to make sure that we have something that's attached to the legislative record that actually shows the diversity, equity, and inclusion plan and actually here if we're hitting those numbers. Some of the numbers that I've been watching on a regional basis are staggering. Even though we've had voluntary community benefits agreements, we're not really seeing the numbers that we need to see in minority and female business enterprise in Cleveland small business. So, and I'm also concerned that from what I'm understanding that there that some of these places are going to national firms and not using local firms, and that's a concern of mine too. So how do we make sure that we're advocating for local firms, making sure that we're advocating for project labor, PLAs, and then mm-hmm. also making sure that we are hitting our, you know, diversity and inclusion numbers?
Mr. Chairman, I believe that the contractors through the Browns submit the same OEO participation documentation to our OEO as contractors that we contract directly. I can verify that with OEO, but I believe that is the case.
Okay. Well, we want to verify that. I've always been one to understand that this is our stadium. I know that some people get anxiety about how much we spend on sports teams, but this city has made a decision 50 years ago, 40 years ago, to invest in sports teams, and they do generate a significant revenue to us, but I'm just not confident that we've been seeing the diversity, equity, and inclusion numbers that we need to see. So I'd like to understand more about that, and you know, I'm willing to continue to move this conversation forward, but I do want to have some follow-up about how we're making sure that we see these numbers, that we can actually articulately go out to our public and say, these are the firms that worked on these projects. Okay?
I am going to, if I could, just one follow-up point.
Go ahead.
When ordinance number 547 is up at the table, there will be a representative from the Browns who will be able to answer those questions.
And just to let you know, since it is a companion piece, I am going to hear 547 right after this 525 piece.
Okay. I take that back then.
Okay. So then we'll make sure that we'll bring that person up, and we'll do that. I know I have Councilman Jones, but did you have a point?
I just have a quick point on the procedure, which is that are we officially convened as the Finance Committee or as the Committee of the Whole? I'm trying to figure out if I can vote on this legislation.
We are convened as Committee of the Whole.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
So, right. Mr. Chairman.
Okay, I do have you down, Councilman.
On the point.
I have you down on that point, but is this a process or on the legislation?
This is actually, Mr. Chairman, on the actual legislation.
Okay, I have you on the list. Can I just...
Mr. Chairman.
Okay. All right, so first I have Councilman Polinsic, and then I have Councilman Joe Jones.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, my honorable colleagues. Mr. Chairman, I would concur with your comments wholeheartedly. My question is to the finance director. Was this dollar amount in the budget?
So through the chair to the councilman, there was a $1,050,000 appropriation in the budget of general fund money to the capital repair fund. There are other funds on deposit in the capital repair fund from a couple of prior projects that were authorized by council that did not spend the full amount at the stadium, so that just sort of leftover cash from that work. And then there's also Syntax revenue that comes in, which can only be spent at the stadium.
That's where my confusion is, because I don't remember the 7.9 being in the budget.
To the chair, yeah. It was not in the budget.
Okay. So shouldn't it have been?
Through the chair to the council. So the budget is the operating budget. It's the general fund.
But we also have special funds, et cetera.
Correct. And this is capital money. So as capital money, it would not be found in the operating budget.
I understand it. But we vote on, when we pass the budget, we have special revenue funds. We have it all in there. So that's why I said I don't remember the 7.9 being in there. So you're explain what constitutes the 7.9 million. You indicated it was $1 million.
Could you give those numbers of how you got to the 7.9?
Yeah, through million, the yeah. chair to the councilman, it's the 1.05 million that was appropriated from the general fund,
okay,
plus Syntax revenues.
So the bulk of that is Syntax revenue.
That's correct.
Okay. Now, Mr. Chairman, to the finance director, you indicated just a moment ago that the fund has been depleted. Expand upon that. Educate us.
So through the chair to the councilman, in the lease, there is a schedule at the back that lays out each year the contributions the city is required to make into the capital repair fund.
Okay.
That was set up, I wasn't here for that, but my sense is that was set up to ensure that there was some minimum amount of money set aside for repairs at the stadium. Once that money runs out, the city has a bit more discretion in terms of how and when and to what extent capital repairs are done at the stadium. There's language in the lease that essentially says once that money is spent, the city, in its judgment based on budget situation, more or less, is able to withhold making certain repairs. Now, that only applies to the capital repairs. There's another category of work for which the city is responsible, and that's the emergency repairs, and those are our responsibility, period.
Right. So the fund as of when is depleted?
Through the chair to the councilman, with this appropriation.
It's hasta la vista. The fund is depleted. So I'm assuming in upcoming budgets, you're going to earmark something toward maintenance of the stadium, correct?
Through the chair, I would expect so. It's too early to say exactly what that might look like.
Okay. Well, Mr. Chairman, I'm the only one here at the table that was here when this terrible deal came before us, and I'm proud to say I voted against it because it was a bad deal then, and it's a bad deal today. But I understand legally we are on the hook regardless of whether we like it or not. We're on the hook for certain things. But, Mr. Chairman, I would concur with you that, again, as it pertains to the work that's being performed, both architectural work, engineering work, and the actual work itself, the city, MOCAP, the BIV administration should be doing everything possible to make sure that we're using as many local contractors and individuals and professional firms as possible. The taxpayers are footing the bill, and we need to derive as many benefits as we can, especially employees and workers in the city of Cleveland. So I understand the limitations that we have. And that's the, I want to state that for the record. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilman Joe Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I concur with my colleague. I also agree with what you stated earlier in asking questions about participation and making sure that Clevelanders are a part of getting the contracts to any kind of projects that are happening in the stadium. But my question, Mr. Chairman, is same line of questioning that happened with the project that was in front of us from Economic Development that talked about financing that the city is going to give to them, but did not have the documentation to support the amount of money. And so we're here again, Mr. Chairman, and there is a figure of $7.9 million in front of us. Why don't we have, Mr. Chairman, to the finance director, a breakdown of that $7.9 million and where it's going to be expenditure to?
Director?
Through the chair to the councilman, it's all coming from the capital repair fund. So there's only one source.
That was
the
question,
accounts.
Mr. Chairman. The question was, we're spending $7.9 million. Why don't we have that breakdown in front of the council so we can understand?
As you explained to Councilman Polensic earlier, how did you get the $1.5 million from the Capitol, the rest of the money from Syntax? Councilman Jones likes to see it in writing, and is there an executive summary where we actually would be able to look at those things?
So through the chair to the councilman, not to that level of detail, there is, in connection with Ordinance 547, a breakdown of the projects.
Yeah.
So what the money is being spent on.
And that is a companion piece, Councilman, which we're about to hear next.
So the executive breakdown is going to be in the companion piece of 547-2022?
Through the chair to the councilman, that's correct. So the total... The transfer, the ordinance 525, is the transfer of the $7.9 million to the Special Revenue Fund so that the city can pay for the work. Ordinance 547-2022, and 525 is from finance. 547 is from MOCAP, and it delineates the work that will be done. It authorizes the city to enter into contracts or to reimburse the team for the work that is being done. And it also has the total cost, which is the $10.5 million figure in the summary for 547. And that includes, that is the $7.9 million that's being transferred into the Special Revenue Fund, the carryover balance from prior Browns projects that did not spend the fully appropriated amount. And then there's a $500,000 amount being appropriated for the city to enter into a contract with a firm to do the next capital repair audit. So under the lease, there's There is required to be a capital repair audit every 5 years. The last one was done in 2018, and so this legislation will also authorize the city to enter into a contract with a firm to conduct the next capital repair audit.
And Mr. Chairman, thank you, Mr. Chairman, to the director. Looking at the companion piece here, 547-2022, do you have a breakdown of where that $7.9 million?
We're going to get into 547 next. I want to make sure that we deal with 525 first.
But I understand, Mr. Chairman, but it's a part of this. Will you be able to break that down and show us where that's at in this process?
So through
when we get to that piece.
Through the chair to the councilman, if you're asking the breakdown of what the 7.9 will be spent on, then yes, that is in the next piece of legislation.
Okay, great. And then, Mr. Chairman, lastly, because I know we have a long day and I don't want to, you know, spend too much time here on this, is the director talked about what will be remaining. I know Syntax is constantly renewing itself. Is that correct, Mr. Chairman, to the director?
Through the chair to the councilman, I wouldn't say it's renewing itself. On one hand, it's a good thing that it is declining each year. That means people are drinking and smoking maybe a little bit less. But it does come in each year. It has been declining over the years, though.
And Mr. Chairman, what is the revenue in that Syntax currently?
Through the chair to the councilman, I'd have to confirm that. I don't know off the top of my head.
Okay. So, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to know the annual revenue that comes into the Syntax and then how those monies are spent, because I know, Mr. Chairman, that there's other financial obligations tied to that, and I want to know a little bit more about how that works. And then lastly, Mr. Chairman, none of this money that we're talking about here, all of this money is actually coming from the Syntax location?
Through the chair to the councilman, I guess one initial point on the Syntax, it is legally only allowed to be spent at the stadium,
yeah.
On projects at the stadium. Second, of the $7.9 million, $1.05 million of that was a general fund appropriation in the operating budget. So $6.85 million is Syntax, $1.05 million is general fund.
And we had to do that. We had to spend the general fund dollars in order to do that, Mr. Chairman, to the director.
Through the chair to the councilman, I don't know that we had to do that, but the appropriation was made for this purpose.
I see. No further questions, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Thank you. Councilman Brian Casey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, to the chief, just to reiterate, and I don't want to jump ahead with the next piece of legislation, but between both pieces of legislation, is the total going to be 10.5 for both pieces, correct? All right, and then also, just so that we have this clear, this is the last piece of legislation, Mr. Chairman, to the chief, where we will have general fund dollars that we have to obligate to repair either at least capital, correct?
So through the chair to the councilman, it depends. So we have certain monies that are set aside, you know, Syntax.
I'm just talking general fund. I'm not talking Syntax dollars,
yeah.
Right.
And I think to get to that ultimate answer, it depends on what the emergency repairs are, most importantly, because the city is obligated to pay for those no matter what.
Right.
And if the emergency repairs in any given year, for example, exceed what we have in other sort of earmarked cash, mm-hmm. we would be in a position where we might have to provide general fund dollars to pay for those repairs.
And then, Mr. Chairman, to the chief, can Syntax dollars be used for emergency repair?
Through the chair to the councilman, yes.
And then do you know, Mr. Chairman, to the chief, how much money, you don't know what we generate a year from the Syntax for the stadium, do you?
Through the chair, not off the top of my head, but okay. I can confirm that.
All right. And then one last question, Mr. Chairman, to the chief. What if we don't pass this?
Through the chair to the councilman, it would raise questions about our performance under the lease. And I know just in terms of practical concerns, it would push construction, the work on these repairs into the season itself and could potentially interfere with.
So technically, I mean, for a term that I may use later on today, we're paying for the sins of our brother, right, from 1998, right? I mean, we're still dealing with this legislation from 1998 from the lease that we signed with the stadium, correct?
Through the chair, these are our obligations under that original
lease. Right, and then Mr. Chairman, to the chief, that ends when?
Through the chair, it expires in 2028. I
believe. Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Thank you, Councilman Casey. Hearing no more questions, ordinance number 525-2022 stands approved. Please sign on. All right, we're going to hear the companion piece to 525-2022, which is ordinance number 547-2022 by Council Members Bishop and Griffin by departmental request, an emergency ordinance determining the method of making the public improvement of constructing material capital repairs and capital improvements to First Energy Stadium, authorizing one or more public improvement contracts for the making of the improvement, and professional services to design or, in the alternative, to reimburse or accept the gift of design and other services from the Cleveland Brown Stadium Company, LLC, and for the performance of a capital repair audit at First Energy Stadium. Director.
Mr. Chief. Chairman, can I ask a point of order question?
Yes.
I'm just confused. We're hearing all this as a committee of the whole, correct?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So wouldn't we all need to sign these then, since we're a committee of the whole? Because we're not being heard by a specific committee. In other words, you called the role to be a committee of the whole. So it's not the finance committee where everybody's president. So if the committee's whole here, wouldn't everybody from the committee of the whole need to sign the legislation?
No, we just have finance would need to do it. We need to vote on it tonight on the floor as committee of the whole. It's not, we've never had where a committee of the whole is supposed to sign a piece of legislation.
But have you ever heard legislation by the committee of the whole?
I mean, just to sign the committees that you're on.
Right.
So for example, there was a safety piece. So if there's safety and you're on safety and finance, you would sign safety and finance. So basically the reason that we announce committee as a whole is not to vote on as a whole body, but to be able to hear all of the pieces from the combined committees.
So you're just keeping these as the regular committees, but you took the role as a committee of a whole.
Yeah, because that gives you...
Which would seem to indicate that we'd have the right to...
The way it was explained to me when I asked that question last week, and we can actually, if we need to get another legal opinion, is in order to be able to hear pieces that the other committees, Public Works has put forth committees that they've relieved out of their committee.
Right.
Public Safety has put forth pieces that they've relieved out of their committee. So in order to be able to hear those, it's almost like we're having sort of a joint committee. So the committee of the whole is basically encompassing all of the different committees.
Okay.
So that's the way that it has been explained to me.
Okay.
You signed.
Councilman the Dean and Council.
Just a point of information. Everyone who's at the table would sign the committee that you're on. So as a piece of legislation comes around, you would sign it as a committee. You're part of the committee of the whole.
Right.
That committee.
Councilman Harsh, you had a point of question.
Mr. Chairman, so if I'm not on any of the committees that are being questioned for this legislation, do I need to be here right now? I'm confused about why I'm here. This is all
finance. So, for example, DPS has put forth pieces of legislation that, I mean, there are different committees that have not heard some of these pieces. Public Works, Public Safety, there's a couple of pieces that they have done. So this is basically, they've relieved it to committee of the whole. So we're hearing multiple committees at once. It's like a joint committee hearing pretty much.
But if a committee I'm on already saw one of these pieces and already voted on it,
then you wouldn't have to be here if you didn't want to be here.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Councilman McCormick.
But just a quick point of order on that though. I would just say though that it's similar to the budget. When the council president calls a committee of the whole, it's expected that everyone is here.
That's right.
I mean, so just as a point on that, like, I don't know, maybe legally, technically, do you not have to be here because you're not signing a piece, but a committee of the whole, you're expected to be here all day.
All right. Okay. I think we have clarification on that. So I want to make sure that we go to for ordinance number 547-2022 by council members Bishop and Griffin by departmental requests and emergency ordinance determining the method of making the public improvement of constructing material capital repairs and capital improvements to First Energy Stadium, authorizing one or more public improvement contracts for the making of the improvement and professional services or to design or in the alternative to reimburse or accept the gift of design and other services from the Cleveland Browns Stadium Company, LLC, and for the capital and for the performance of a capital repair audit of First Energy Stadium. Director, and did you have, I know you have, we're joined by Chief DeRosa or Director DeRosa, but do we also have somebody from the Cleveland Browns here?
Through the chair, I think that was the plan, but okay. When the ordinance was going to be heard later in the day.
So I'll defer to the director. Director, please.
So, Mr. Chairman, not to review what we just reviewed with the companion piece. What I'd like to do is go through here what the expenditures are actually for, and it really breaks down to three different categories. There's emergency repairs, there's capital repairs, and then there's the audit, which, as we mentioned, is required by the lease every 5 years. And so we, emergency repairs are defined in the lease as those that would endanger the health and safety of the people working in or attending an event at the stadium. And so that's a very specific definition that our Division of Architecture and Site Development, Carter Edmond and his team then went out to the stadium to tour, to look at these items to make sure that they fit into that category. Likewise, there's capital repairs, which have a specific definition but are not emergency in nature. Those were also reviewed as the tour of the stadium with the facilities folks happened. And so I'd like to go through what each of those expenditures are for the emergency and capital repairs, and I'm going to turn it over to Carter here to go through that list.
Thank you, Director. To the chair, as Director DeRosa mentioned, I toured the facility myself with one of my project managers who's also very familiar with the stadium, and we reviewed these to make sure that they qualify under the terms of the lease for emergency and capital repairs respectively, but also to make sure that they didn't fall under some of the exclusions in the lease, such as enhancements, repairs that need to be done because of actions of the lessee and so forth. So these are ones that we have vetted personally with eyes on the situation. Pedestrian ramp replacement is pretty self-explanatory. These are the ramps that lead people in and out of the upper levels of the stadium. There is spalling, concrete, rusting deck, and so forth that we believe qualifies as emergency repairs. The transfer switch replacement, this is an automatic electrical switch that transfers from normal to emergency power in the event of a power loss. Right now that switch is inoperable and needs to be operated by hand by someone in the event of a power loss. So things like emergency lighting go down, they don't come back up until someone goes and switches it by hand. Heater replacements, these are radiant electrical heaters in various locations throughout the stadium. And they are arcing and sparking, and parts to fix them are no longer available. So those need to be replaced. Surge protection, that's exactly what it says. It's a very large version of a surge protector that protects electrical equipment throughout the stadium. Luminary replacements, these are primarily interior lights, and that the luminaries themselves are failing and can no longer provide the code required illumination at the walking surface for egress. Fire pump replacement, this is for the sprinkler system that serves the stadium to provide adequate water pressure for that. Gutter replacements, these are gutters throughout the stadium that are currently leaking, letting water into interior areas of the stadium, causing secondary damage. Door frame and hardware replacements, these are primarily exterior doors. It's just what it says. They've been subject to exterior weathering, corrosion. Some don't open, close but don't latch. It's a pretty standard door hardware. Plaza light fixture, this is exterior illumination to provide code required lumens on the walking surface. VAV box replacements, these are components of the HVAC system that provide temperature and fresh air control in occupied spaces. Raker beam paintings, the raker beams are the large diagonal beams that hold up the upper portions of the bowl. So painting is a qualified capital repair as long as it hasn't been done within 5 years. So we did observe where that painting is needed. Domestic hot water pump replacement. It has the stadium has a circulating domestic hot water system, and the pump needs to be replaced. Joint repairs. These are structural joints throughout the stadium. There, you can see them as you're sort of walking around on the plaza level. They're they allow movement between structural components of the stadium, but as that movement occurs over the years, those joints lose their flexibility and start to crack and allow water into the interior spaces. Concrete replacement, that's various spalling and cracking throughout the exterior concrete. And bathroom stall replacement, that's just what it says. It's the metal stalls within the restrooms that have become rusted out over the years. And then the final item is, as mentioned, the capital audit, which we are obliged to conduct every 5 years.
All right, thank you. Just a follow-up question. Has a firm been picked already? So no firm has been picked to do this work yet? Is there a prime or an owner's rep that oversees all of the work? Or
We act as the owner's rep overseeing the work. These will likely be a variety of different contracts. There may be some opportunities to combine, say, electrical things that make sense, but this is not all going to be one big contract.
Okay, so as I asked earlier, are we looking at local? Because there's several companies local that can do this, and how are we making sure on the front end, not you know, buy me a hamburger and I'll gladly pay you Tuesday. Mm-hmm. How are we doing on the front end to make sure that we have MBE, FBE, small business, mm-hmm. and how we're making sure we're, you know, doing PLAs or anything else on this project?
So to the chair, on the design and professional services side, we have a mailing list of, you know, that we send out RFPs to, and we continually work with OEO to update that mailing list. And that is very heavily weighted on local firms. And then on the bidding side, as I mentioned, we will be involved in the bidding process, whether DPS is actually bidding it out or the Browns are. They will be required to submit OEO schedules just like any other project that we bid out.
Well, I'm interested to see that data because, once again, I got several calls that there had already been someone picked and it was an out-of-town person and that they did not have much of any minority participation and female participation. So if that's false, I'd love to see the data. If you guys could help me look into that, but I'd love to see that.
To the chair, I'm not sure what project that's in reference to. Johnson Controls obviously is a national firm. It's a little bit unusual because there's an existing system in place and there's not very many firms that could do that work. Okay. But again, I'm not sure what that's in reference to, so we can look into that.
All right. Councilman Mike Polinsik.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, my honorable colleagues, and to the director, first of all, congratulations on your new appointment, full-time.
Yes.
Well-deserving. Well-deserving. Okay. Now start buying a Mylanta. Okay. Okay. Now. Okay. Now. Now. I'm to the director of finance. I'm really confused here now. This is 10.5 million, 547. The piece we just discussed was 7.9. Is a 7.9 part of the 10?
Through the chair of the councilman, yes. So the, these are companion pieces. The total project is $10.5 million. That is comprised essentially of two sources. One is funds that were on hand that were already appropriated in prior years that just didn't get spent. The work came in under budget. Or there were reserves that were released as part of that work. And then the 7.9 is the balance.
So again, so why didn't you just come in with one piece?
Through the chair, the legislation's, the pieces are doing two very different things. One is appropriating the money from one account to the other. The other is authorizing MOCAP to enter into contracts.
So Chief, let me make sure that I can say this. 525 was the deposit that we put in the bank. 547 is how we're paying the bills from the deposit that we put in the bank. That's pretty much what we're trying
to the chair,
do.
Yes.
Okay, so Mr. Chairman, where does the rest of the money come from to make up the total, the 10? Where does
through the chair to the councilman, it's in previously appropriated funds that were not spent.
And is there a balance in unappropriated funds for this? Or is this, there is no balance after that? You said funds that had not been spent.
Correct. So through the chair to the councilman, there were prior capital repair requests over the years that the city has approved and appropriated funds for. The Browns, either for those projects, came in under budget or had reserves that were released and went back into the fund. And so
again, Mr. Chairman, through the director, so there's no fund balance anymore after this and that?
Through the chair, assuming they spend all of it, correct.
So you say, okay, that's what I'm trying to understand here. So trying to figure out who's on first and who's on second here. Okay.
Councilman Pelosi, would you allow Councilman Caldwell a point? On that point, just a point on this point.
You know what, I understand it's in the rear.
You want to read the list?
Why don't you guys bring things in there and not like that to show? Or you footnote it here, you can footnote what you just narrated. I don't understand it, and you know you can do that. You just mentioned it was some other money that we didn't spend. All right, it's there. You could have footnoted that, and that way we know there, that commitment. I don't understand that. Why you didn't do it?
All right. I'm not sure why you didn't do that, but can you in the future just make sure we footnote that so that we can make sure, because that's a good point. That would clarify anything for carryover and all that. So.
Okay.
All right. So the Councilman Polensic has the floor. Yes. Do we have questions that you want to be on the list, or do you have something on a point? Okay, so I'll put everybody on the list. I do have Councilman Bishop and Councilman Slife is up next.
So, to follow up on the question of the Council President, when was the last work to the director of MOCAP? When was the last work performed at the stadium? Do you know?
They did perform work last year, and they've already started work on the ramp replacements. Because there's so many ramps that they need to have replaced, they've started sequencing those so that they're done before the season starts.
So then I would request through the chair of the contracts that have been awarded for the last, we'd like to know who the companies are.
Okay.
Who got the contracts. So then we can start to see a bigger picture as to who's benefiting from these public dollars that are going into this facility. And then again, specifically for the ramps, you're telling us that the ramps are wore out already?
Through the chairman, yes. Do you have anything to elaborate on the ramps?
These are the pedestrian ramps in the stadium.
Through the chair to the council member, yes, that's correct. There's been an ongoing process of ramp replacement over the last several years. And these are reinforced concrete ramps that are exposed on top, bottom, and all sides on the exterior. And they're 25 years old, and yes, they're corroding significantly.
Okay, I just wondered, were they built properly?
In my opinion, they were. Obviously, I wasn't here when they were built, but I think this is an expected lifespan for this type of construction in an exterior condition.
Okay. Cha-ching. Okay. Here we go again. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilman Charles Slifton, Councilman Joe Jones, Councilman Starr and Division.
Try my phone. Thank you. And Mr. Chair, this is more of a procedural question. So there's, in addition to these pieces on the stadium we're hearing, there's also Councilman Casey's resolution about the name of the stadium. And I guess I'm just curious, through the chair to the administration, is there any legal reason why our legislation needs to include the branded name of the stadium? Are we able to refer to it as city-owned facility or 100 Alfred Lerner Way? Seems like we're potentially conflicting with ourselves, Mr. Chair. That's why I ask.
I think we might have to get a legal opinion on that, to be honest with you. We do have the attorney here. So do we need to...
Where's our attorney?
Should we, will we be able to, did you hear the councilman's question?
Vaguely, it had something to do.
Could we just refer to, instead of it being First Energy Stadium, is it possible just to say municipal owned facility
or
the address of the stadium?
Is there any description sufficient to identify the property should be acceptable?
Okay. Mr. Chair, to that end, I'd make an amendment to strike First Energy Corporation from the legislation and replace it with publicly owned football stadium at 100 Alfred Lerner Way.
So we have an amendment that has been put forth on the floor. Is there a second to that amendment?
Second, Mr. Chairman.
There is an amendment and a second to name, to strike First Energy Stadium in ordinance number 547 and refer to all references of First Energy Stadium as the city-owned facility at 100 Alfred Lerner Way. Is that what I'm hearing you say, Councilman? Is that correct?
That's correct.
Do we have a second from Councilman Jones? Is there any further discussion? Hearing no discussions, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it. Please make that appropriate amendment to strike First Energy Stadium and just put municipal facility at 100 Alfred Lerner Way.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you so much. Councilman Joe Jones and then Councilman Starr and Bishop.
Mr. Chairman, I think that, talking to the director would be very helpful, and I think we kind of like talked a little bit about this, so I won't spend much time at it. Is when you're bringing financing deals like this to the table, to be really clear on how it works and where the financing is coming from, and then showing the breakdowns would be very helpful, so that as members of council, we can just pretty much go through your executive summary, understand exactly how the financing is broken down here, and where those funds come from and what those balances are. That would be very helpful in the future. It's just a part of the whole portfolio in terms of the executive summary of putting things together. Even looking at this, Mr. Chairman, to the director, I still don't see, I'm quite sure it's in here, but that breakdown of that 7.9 and a really fundamental go through where these funds at, where that 1.05 million is coming into the whole proposition, and what will be left over in terms of balance. So the question, Mr. Chairman, and I will yield back my time, Mr. Chairman, is when we look at this that's in front of us right now, you stated, Mr. Chairman, to the director that maybe they're spend this money. So I wasn't for sure where will they be spending it at, what will they not use, would there be anything left over once we approve here at this table the $10.5 million that's being requested.
So through Chief. The chair to the councilman, I think, the good faith expectation is that this money will be spent on the purposes that are listed in the executive summary for the legislation. That said, things happen, and so it could end up, it's unlikely given I think the inflationary world we're living in, but it could end up the case that one of these projects doesn't cost as much as was budgeted. So there could be funds left over, but I given what we're seeing in the world, I'd be pretty surprised if that happened.
No further questions, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilman Richard Starr, and then Councilman Bishop, Councilman Conwell.
Now, Council President, I just wanted to ask a couple of different questions just for clarification when it regards to some of these projects that happen in the city. And what I mean by that is I see that we pass legislations on projects to be developed, but then when I look at the ordinance or the summary, I mean, the breakdown is not to every dollar for us to understand what's going on. And something that you referenced that stuck in my ear, Council President, to the panel, was the fact that we got $10 million, but we don't know what construction company, who are doing any subcontracts. We don't know who really is the general contractor. And I have a big problem with that personally, because a lot of different deals get done and we just get the little small summary, not understanding from our end what is going on. Meaning, if we're going to pass any piece of legislation or even just from general rule, if somebody wants land or money in the city of Cleveland, it has to come through council. So when it comes to council, if it isn't all the way prepared correctly, meaning we know where the last dollar, who's going to be the person sweeping, who's going to be flag guarding, who's going to do the HVAC, who's going to do the construction, who's going to repair the emergency repairs, the capital repairs. If we don't have those type of information, why are we just giving it to the administration to just approve what we want to do? Because according to the studies and the research that I found, almost 95% of the things that administration wants to do or can do has to come through council. And if it has to come to council, we should be asking for every little bit of thing, because we all get on these emails and it's 597 people talking about a project that happened in the city of Cleveland. And those of us who have authority to oversight this project really didn't even get the chance to vet it completely. And I think as a council, we have to stick together to make the change. And I'm not going to mention it, but my colleague told me about the deal on this deal from the 90s and how horrible it was. And here we're 2022, they still getting to do whatever they want as far as the repairs that we're by lease agreement obligated to do. But also we should be able to say the local businesses in the city should be first dib, and we need to prioritize that to know exactly what's going on. And I just want to ask the administration chair to the administration, like, how is this actually being brought to us? And when it just shows that $10.5 million, and then we got $7.9 coming from here that was carried over cash that we're going to add to basically a budget of $10.5. I also want to know, where's the shortcoming of the $3 million plus dollars? And who is getting these contracts? Mm-hmm. You know, that is very important to our local businesses. When I talk to the Office of Equal Opportunity about a list of just MBE, FBE, everybody who's certified to do business in the city of Cleveland, we still ain't got that list broken down to know who can do development and construction, who can do HVAC, who can do the general contractors. That is how we're going to get our city to head, by making sure the diversity, equity, and inclusion. If we don't do that as a council, we're struggling and we're failing the businesses, our people, and we're just allowing things to go on. Like I said, 95% of the things that administration, the mayor can say what he wants to do, has to come through council. And when it comes to council, in the words of council, the dean himself, we're going to vet it. And we need to see everything as it is to that last dollar, because we the ones get chewed out when it don't go right. And they don't mind putting us on the email with 600 people, and we all be like, what is this coming at 6 on a Sunday morning?
Before the administration answers, I do want to make sure that I clarify a couple of things, because Councilman, you know, we're going to revisit our whole community benefits agreement, and I've already convened a working group with council policy committee that's been working on some tools that we can look at legislatively. I will tell you that the administration has the responsibility to negotiate or execute contracts. So when we pass these dollars, a lot of it has been good faith, and I totally agree with you. How do we get out of good faith and start making it mandatory? But I will tell you that there are several lawsuits that we've had to work around at the state level and other places in order to that kind of stripped some language that we could use around mandatory. But we do have a group working on that, and I really want to make sure that I encourage you to be a part of that, because you're exactly right. We are already starting to examine how we can mandate it to come through council. But as it stands now, the council passes the legislation, but the administration has the responsibility to negotiate the actual terms of participation in the contract. So we'll, those are nuances we're trying to work through.
Thank you, Chair.
But I don't know if any of you wanted to add to that. Director DeRosa, I know you have some background in this.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, the councilman, I guess what I want to say, it is we hear you, we hear what you're saying. This is kind of step two in this process with the Browns, maybe step three. I mean, we have this facilities assessment that kind of guides us towards what will be coming in future years as far as repairs go. There's the emergency repairs that you know, sort of come out of the blue, if you will, but then there's this assessment that guides you to what's coming in the future. And so maybe that's a tool that we can use. You know, there's an allocation in here for that new assessment, but maybe that's a tool that we can use to identify work that should be coming and identifying contractors that would fit into that bucket of work, so that we could sort of prime the pump with local contractors that could get that work.
Thank you, Chair. That's just my main point, Chair, to the panel. Making sure, you know, that diversity, equity, inclusion is forefront on projects, because, you know, we get killed about people, not even contractors who certify to do the work, not even having any awareness, not even the opportunity. And that's where things go downhill. And that's when you lose trust within the community, because it's like, we don't know what happened, but we all be confused, or we just found out from Cleveland.com.
But Councilman, you totally have my commitment, and you know we're gonna make sure that happens.
Thank you.
Okay? All right, I do have Councilman Bishop and then Conwell. And just for process and order, I do want to get through human resources and public utilities before we break, because we know this is a long day. So once again, if these have been vetted through a committee already, just keep that in mind. Councilman Bishop and then Councilman Conwell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, seeing this piece of legislation didn't come through the Municipal Services Committee, we are kind of making this decision on the fly. And I hear what Councilman Polensic has said and Councilman Starr has said, and it's concerning, and it's also my concern also. I would like to see the contractors that has been used by the to perform the work at the Brown Stadium, because you know that old adage where you steal from the rich and give to the poor. It seems like we are stealing from the poor and giving to the rich in this case. It's kind of backwards. So it's important that when we allocate $10 million from our city budget, from our city, whether it's capital, whether it's general fund, that we make sure that it's, we are giving back to the local economy, and so to speak. Now, do you have the MOCAP, do you have any photos of these deteriorated ramps? Because like Councilman Polensic said, I know that cement deteriorates when you put salt on them, but if it's an unsalted ramp, or I'm not sure what they use on these ramps, do you have any photos of these deteriorated ramps so our committees can see this work that needs to be done?
Through the chair to the council member, I do, and I can provide those, and I've also seen them myself. I've walked through the whole area.
Could you send them to our council Representative Ms. Sabin, I believe, is going to handle that so that we can distribute to all of council. Okay?
Okay. Councilman? All right, Mr. Chairman.
All right, thank you, Councilman Bishop. Councilman Kevin Conwell.
Thank you very much. Can I get a microphone? I was told. No, going through the chair to the, and congratulations on your hiring. You mentioned, how much you mentioned we had to pay for capital and we had to pay for repairs. I can see the capital, but the repairs is how much?
So the capital repairs are, let's see, do you have, let's see. I got that here.
I see the capital repairs is in here, I see it. You know what, you need to go in here also and through the chair to the finance director. Put in there preventive maintenance. I always push that. I mean, it's just like you got a car and you don't change your oil or you don't rotate your tires or you don't do preventive maintenance on your vehicle. You're going to spend money in the long run and say, oh, well, I'll go in front of council. They'll approve the money. I mean, you got to put in, you have to put in preventive maintenance and how much it's going to save us. I mean, you know you're going to hit these numbers every year, see how much you're going to spend on capital repairs. But when you put that preventive maintenance in, that saved dollars. All businesses have that, through the chair to the finance director, as well as the other, as well as Jamie, director of capital projects. Sir?
Ms. Chairman, the councilman, so I can speak to that. You know, the good news is that the Browns are responsible for the ongoing regular maintenance of the stadium. So while we do have a lot of costs related to the stadium, we don't take on all the costs. Mm-hmm. So they are responsible for preventative maintenance. Part of what the assessment does is keeps track of sort of how long certain assets should last,
and
gives them a guideline for how to maintain certain parts of the stadium so that they last that long.
Gotcha.
So that's one piece, and then we should have had a little total here underneath each of these items you see in the legislative summary, but the emergency repairs, we have them outlined by item, but they total $4,977,000.
I see that. Okay.
And then you have the capital repairs that are there listed by item, and those ones pencil out to $5,056,150.
Mm-hmm. You know what? I'm glad you told me that. And let me say this, and I'll close out for sake of time. We need you to do that even in the city buildings, mm-hmm. at the recreation center, whatever the case may be. Have guys, you know when a project lifeline is going to end. You kind of know because you do projections. And then we start doing preventive maintenance on it. So that way we don't have to come to the table to spend $100,000 here, $200,000. Then we can become more efficient instead of being inefficient. Inefficient, I mean. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilman Conwell. Hearing no more questions, ordinance number 547-2022 stands approved. Thank you. Just for process sake, I do have one more for finance. And then, ladies and gentlemen, I do want to get through human resources and public utilities. They should be very brief. These were vetted. So once again, we're going to hear through those couple of pieces, okay? And then we'll break after we do those two things, all right? So this one is resolution number 540-2022 by Councilmember Griffin by departmental request, an emergency resolution to adopt and declare a tax budget for the City of Cleveland for the year 2023 and submit it to the County Budget Commission as required by state law, Chapter 5705 of the revised code. Director, Chief.
Through the chair to the council. So what you have here is an annual requirement that the revised code puts on all taxing jurisdictions in the state under section 5705-28 of the revised code, where the city has to essentially certify to the total expenditures and the total estimated revenues for the upcoming fiscal year.
Okay.
I can leave it at that and answer any questions.
Pretty straightforward. don't have any questions regarding 540-2022. Stands approved. Please sign on. Thank you. Good to see you, Mr. Cordick. Chief, you will be coming back for 532 and 533. And also, you and Director DeRosa will be coming for that, right?
Yeah.
Okay. That'll be this afternoon. Okay. We're going to ask Chief Patton if he could join us at the table for Human Resources. We have two pieces from Human Resources. First is 456-2022 by Councilmember Griffin, by departmental request, an emergency ordinance authorizing the Director of Human Resources to enter into one or more contracts with a computer software vendor to provide a subscription-based or license-based learning management system suite, which will include both a learning management system and learning content management system and related services for a period of 1 year, with 3 one-year options to renew, exercisable by the Director of Human Resources. Chief.
Good afternoon, members of council, Mr. Chairman. This piece of legislation will allow us to implement training citywide on an electronic basis.
It
will
Please speak into the mic. I want to make sure everybody hears you. Okay.
This piece of legislation will allow us to provide training citywide for our employees and managers. It will also require, it will also allow us to do all the required and mandatory training. And track that training and make sure that we are compliant.
Okay, thank you. Pretty straightforward. Do we have any questions regarding 456-2022? Seeing no questions, 456-2022 stands approved. Please sign on.
Yes.
The next one we have is ordinance number 494-2022 by Councilmember Griffin by departmental request, an emergency ordinance to amend sections 48, 49, and 50 of ordinance 194-2021 passed March 29, 2021 as amended relating to compensation for various classifications. Director.
Mr. President, members of the committee, this is amending the pay band legislation to be compliant with our prevailing wages for building and construction trades. We are required by law to implement prevailing wages, not only nationally, but in Ohio. Ohio requires us to implement 80% of the national prevailing wage, and this will ensure compliance. There is one additional pay band opportunity to increase for the Cleveland Municipal Courts. They have requested a pay band increase for one of their hard-to-fill positions, which is court interpretation services.
Okay. All right. Do we have any questions regarding 494-2022, Councilman Jones?
Mr. Chairman, I'm looking at the bands here and looking at the they're making an hour, like a bricklayer is $57 an hour. Is that right? Am I looking at that right, Mr. Chairman, to the director?
Director.
And a boilermaker at $72.44 an hour?
Through the chair to the councilman, these are both the minimum and maximum ranges of these particular classifications. On some cases, employees, depending on their level of service and experience, are provided step increases along those lines. But these are the minimum, maximum prevailing wage rates we need to implement.
Mr. Chairman, you know, I don't really have anything here on in terms of questioning on this particular piece, but just looking at the hourly rates for most of this work is certainly a discussion that we had at this table earlier. We need to look back at how we develop a relationship with CMSD and make sure that our schools are offering these various different skills, cement finisher, bricklayer, boiler maker, cement finisher. All of these skills, Mr. Chairman, is something that our children are not leaving out of schools with, who are not going to college, should have these skill sets, and it's something that, you know, we should talk about how we create that stable, so to speak, with CMSD to start seeing how we can get our young people into these various different trades. And Mr. Chairman, I have no unreadiness on the
Thank
piece.
Thank you, Councilman. Great comments, and definitely I think Councilwoman Santana has taken note. Seeing no more questions, ordinance. Oh, we have Councilwoman Moore.
Thank you, Chair. Just briefly, Chief Patton, I know that there are some other aspects of city, other pay bands that we've been looking to increase for a while. Could you just give us a broad description of what it takes to get a pay band increase across the finish line at the city through the chair?
Through the chair, to the councilwoman, all the pay band recommendations and increases have to come through city council, so they're recommended by administration and approved through council.
Thank you. So, for instance, with the building inspectors, where we want to offer more competitive pay, we need to make sure that the administration makes those recommendations. They're approved by you. They come here to council for us to approve, and then we can implement them through the chair.
Through the chair to the councilwoman. That's part of the story. So some of these pay bands are generally very, very broad and do accommodate the targeted salaries that we're trying to administer. Some are not. So we need to look at the pay bands in context of having a much better job of making sure that they make sense.
Okay, thank you. So through the chair, could you clarify if there are other pay bands that you're anticipating changing this summer?
Through the chair to the councilwoman, we intend to take a comprehensive look at all of them and make some recommendations. I don't know if that'll be this summer or later in the year.
Thank you very much. And one last question. Could you just describe the interplay here between the pay band conversation and the union contracts that are being negotiated through the chair?
Through the chair to the councilwoman, the union contract negotiated rates will also come through city council in the form of a pay band. So we would typically negotiate the rate and make sure that we have the pay band necessary to pay those rates. If those pay bands do not accommodate the rates, we have to come through city council.
Thank you, Chief.
All right. Thank you. Seeing no more questions, ordinance number 494-2022 stands approved. Thank you, Chief Patton. I'm going to bring up public utilities, and once again, once we bring up public utilities, then we're going to break. So please keep this in mind. This has been vetted. All of these have been vetted through the Public Safety Committee. Utilities Committee. All right. First and foremost, we have ordinance number 502-2022 by Council Members Gray, Casey, Hairston, and Griffin by departmental request, an emergency ordinance authorizing the Commissioner of Purchases and Supplies to sell certain city-owned property not needed for public use located in the vicinity of 9103 Buckeye Road to Michele LaGrasso Development Company, LLC, for the purposes of business expansion and proffering certain representations for purposes of the amended and restated trust indenture from the City of Cleveland. Director.
Mr. Chairman, members of council, representing Director Kane, this is to sell a piece of property and building that is owned by Cleveland Public Power that is no longer needed for its operating purposes. It'll be sold to Maselli Dairy to expand their cheesemaking operations, which are just across the street from them.
Okay, great. This was heard in DPS Chairman Casey.
This was heard in utilities.
Utilities was heard in utilities, Chairman Casey.
Duly vetted and recommended for passage, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Councilman Hairston, you've relieved this from DPS?
He's ready to pull.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
All right, thank you. Councilwoman Gray, this is actually your area of record. Do you support ordinance number 502-2022?
Yes, I do, Chairman.
All right, thank you. Councilwoman Gray and myself had a chance to visit this project last week, and do think it's a great project. So seeing no more questions.
So move.
Ordinance number 502-2022 stands approved. Please sign on.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right, Next one is ordinance number 528-2022 by council members Casey and Griffin by departmental request, an emergency ordinance authorizing the director of public utilities to exercise the first option to renew contract number PS 2019-266 with Interpersonal Frequency LLC to provide website hosting services for the various divisions of the Department of Public Utilities. Director.
In lieu of the director, Chief Lasik, IT. This is our hosting contracts for our websites and security through interpersonal frequency, and this is just a plus one to the contract.
So all right, thank you. So, Councilman Casey, this was heard in public utilities.
Duly vetted and recommended for passage, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Seeing no questions, ordinance number 528-2022 stands approved. Please sign on. Next one is ordinance number 534-2022 by council members Casey and Griffin by departmental request, an emergency ordinance authorizing the director of public utilities to employ one or more professional consultants to host and manage billing systems and related systems and activities for the Division of Water and Cleveland Public Power for a period of 1 year with four options to renew for additional 1 year periods, the second of which is exercisable through additional legislative authority. Director.
Again, Chief Lasik for Director Keene. These are our managed services for a variety of technology projects that we have and services. They include our electronic bill print and presentation, the customer care and billing system, and a variety of other services.
Thank you. Councilman Casey.
Duly vetted, recommended for passage.
All right, thank you. Councilman Joe Jones.
Mr. Chairman, is this the first? Is this the, this is just a boilerplate, Mr. Chairman, or is this something new that we're letting out,
Through the chair to the councilman. Yes. We are at the end of our 5-year contract that we had before, so now we're going to go out for an RFP again for these services.
I see. And Mr. Chairman, on this contract, this allows you the opportunity to, you don't need to come back to the council. You can go ahead and agree to this for another 2 or 3 years.
No. This
once they pick someone, then they have to come back for us for approval.
I see. Correct. And what is the total for this service, Mr. Chairman, to the director?
The breakdowns are in the legislation. It's about $7 million when it breaks down.
I see. No further questions, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilman. Hearing no more questions, ordinance number 534-2022 stands approved. Please sign on. All right, ordinance number 536-2022 by council members Casey and Griffin by departmental request, an emergency ordinance authorizing the purchase of one or more requirement contracts of various size PVC and FRE duct line materials for the Division of Cleveland Public Power, Department of Public Utilities for a period of up to 2 years. Director.
Commissioner Barton for Director Keene. Mr. Chairman, members of council, this will enable us to go out for a requirements contract for our underground materials such as PVC duct line and fiber glass reinforced epoxy duct line, the fittings and spacers. This would be for a 2-year period.
All right. As I mentioned earlier, in DEI, diversity, equity, inclusion, I really want to make sure we see that plan. I know that there in the past, there has been some concerns from some other companies about making sure that they had minority participation and when they did the duct work and other things like that. So we really want to make sure we pay close attention to that.
Mr. Chairman, this is for materials, not for actual contract.
Okay, all right.
This is materials that will be used by Cleveland Public Power.
By Public Power, okay. So then this won't be the actual work that they're doing. Okay, that's great. Thank you. Councilman Casey?
This was duly vetted in utilities and recommended for passage, Mr. Chairman.
All right, thank you. Councilman Joe Jones?
So, Mr. Chairman, this is 536-2022?
Yes, sir.
And the director is saying that we don't have a contract with this?
This is giving legislative authority for them to go out and get supplies for
to
this.
Go get a contract. A contractor also, you would still need to deal with a vendor, correct, Mr. Chairman, to the director?
The chairman of the councilman, that's correct.
And so then
it still applies in terms of making sure that we have you know, minorities on these contracts. The last vendor, is this a minority contractor, Mr. Chairman, to the director?
Mr. Chairman, members of council, the last vendor was Leff Electric, which eventually went out of business, and that contract was assumed by Professional Electric Products Company, PEPCO.
And Mr. Chairman, you know, what I will say is, and this is to the director, to the commissioner, do we have a problem with getting contractors to come in and really bid these processes out? And because I've been told that there's a difficult time in terms of actually getting contractors to come in and bid these on these various different projects, because there's a lot of paperwork that's engaged and involved, and it sort of pushes them away from trying to get contracts with the city.
Mr. Chairman, to councilman, they do have to comply with the city's purchasing processes and regulations, including bid bonds and various other affidavits and things like that. That's not on our end as far as a discretionary item.
So you haven't heard that. You just find the way it goes.
Mr. Chairman, members of council, we do get vendors, sometimes more, sometimes less. COVID kind of quieted things down in terms of as many vendors as would come forward for a bid offering, but it's generally a fairly competitive situation.
Right. Mr. Chairman, I would just, you know, suggest that the council, I'm not so sure if it's here, but really take a look into why we're not getting the kind of cooperation in the Cleveland neighborhood as relates to getting contracts and contracts being vetted out. You know, what's the disconnect? Because there's a lot of work that we give out on an annual basis in the hundreds of millions, and it doesn't seem like we don't have the kind of participation we should be getting from our Cleveland residents. And so I've sat here, Mr. Chairman, for about 5 years, and I've seen a lot of these contracts go out to people who don't even, they're not even from the city of Cleveland a lot of times, and they're from other states. You know, so that's what really makes it, Mr. Chairman, really bad when you sit here and see consultants and other institutions and organizations that are getting the work. And so the question is, what do we need to do here at this table to kind of find out if it is an issue of a lot of encumbered stuff that's there that's preventing Clevelanders from having the opportunity or just the know-how, or is it a situation of communications? And that's something that we can sit down and talk about later. But I just wanted to bring that out. Every time I look at these contracts, a lot of times they're not with citizens in the city of Cleveland. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Thank you, Councilman Jones. Councilman Casey, you have a closing point?
Yeah, just for the record, Mr. Chairman, this Leff Electric, who unfortunately closed its business, was a Cleveland-owned business prior to, unfortunately, closing their doors. We did have to go out to a company that was within a suburb, not far from Cleveland, but in the Department of Public Utilities, that's one thing that we always talk about within the committee hearings, is trying to keep everything as local as we can. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilman Casey. Please sign on. Is you had a point, Councilman? Okay. Hold on. I got one more to read, and then we're going to miscellaneous. 1 second. So this will be heard today, and then it will be sent to the floor for consideration tonight. This is ordinance number 615-2022 by council members Casey and Griffin by departmental request, an emergency ordinance to amend section 2 of ordinance number 660-2020 passed September 9, 2020, relating to maintaining control systems and providing proprietary components of the SCADA and PCCS equipment for the Department of Public Utilities. I believe someone is representing Chief Kane or Director Kane?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And Councilman Casey, you are aware of this?
I don't see 615.
Yes, I had a...
This one was actually brought to us because it's time sensitive. It was just brought to us with this. Okay. But go ahead,
So these Chief. Are control systems and components that do the plant operations for us and the maintenance and support
I'm
of
sorry,
them.
I can't hear the distinction.
Oh, sorry. These PCCS, and these are the components of SCADA, some supervisory control and data acquisition. These are the components that do the monitoring and controls of the systems at the plants.
Okay. All right. All right, Councilman Casey is aware of this and they have asked me to move this forward. Does we have any questions, Councilman? Councilman Casey, if you could please expound and then
Mr. Chairman, I did have a robust conversation with the director regarding bringing a piece forward like this. However, this is time sensitive, and basically what this is just a name change.
Correct.
To a company that we already have a contract with. When we went to send billing information out to them, they couldn't accept it anymore because they changed their name. So basically all this is a name change to a company that we already have a contract with.
And if you look at section 2, it basically says what Councilman Casey just said is that this council determines that within commodities of the commodities are non-competitive and cannot be secured from any source other than Hack Company, HSQ Technology, Rexo Inc., and it was formerly Advanced Control Systems Inc., FKA EFACECASC Inc., and now the new company is Minsait, MINSAITACS Inc., FKA Advanced Control System. So basically, it's just a name change.
And the reason it's sensitive to, through the chair to the council is because it is our equipment that monitors those components.
Mr. Chairman, I don't have any readiness for the legislation. I understand that it's time sensitive in that respect. But do we know why they changed their name?
I'm not aware of
because
it. Because
that sometimes can be a red flag as it relates to a business changing their name.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, they were purchased by Minsait.
Okay, so that's the reason why. No further questions, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, move to adopt, please.
All right, thank you. We moved. Thank you, Councilman Hairston. Councilman McCormick needs a few seconds of miscellaneous, if we could.
10 seconds, Chairman. I just want to thank the commissioner. We had a tree catch on fire in the power lines in Ohio City, cutting out the power yesterday. On a Sunday, he was extremely responsive, which we were able to pass the information along to the community. I'm sure you don't get a lot of thank yous, so I just want to thank you for being on top of it yesterday. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. Thank and
Mr. Chairman, I want to add, too, I appreciate
please.
The commissioner's response to a situation I had last week in the neighborhood where he personally came out as well. I thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Barton has always been very responsive. I do have an issue I need to bring to your attention, so I will bring that up in a moment. We're going to adjourn just so that I can make sure that everybody knows our process. I'm asking if everyone can reconvene at 1:10. If everyone can reconvene at 1:10, that would give us a little over a half an hour for lunch, and then we'll start back with port control, and we'll end up our day from there, okay? Thank you. This committee stands adjourned until 1:10 by call of the chair.
More help with that. One example is building and housing for home issues, quality of life issues. Go ahead and go forward. The next concern is paragraph 23 and 24 of the settlement agreement. This involves community engagement. And